waking up and taking action. Again, thank you so much for joining us on this Worldwide Friday edition. The top story up on drudgereport.com is been given directly to Drudge 3 days ahead of the historic debate that may have more viewers than the Super Bowl. And that information is that she will not be allowed any breaks. No commercials, no breaks, 90 minutes straight. And we're going to be here actually taking the feed, licensing the feed, carrying the feed, not just analyzing it in live time, but basically carrying it with limited interruptions. But we'll give a live analysis before and after as well this Monday, Infowars.com/show. The medical doctors are piling on. Democratic doctors are piling on. Rand Paul medical doctors come out and said that she looks like she's got serious neurological problems. As we've pointed out, the eye's not pointing the right direction. Shows serious neurological problems. She wasn't doing this previously. Now medical doctors are coming out and saying that. I shot this video last night. I talked to people in the Democratic Party and also in law enforcement over the last few days. And they say the word is with the Democrats that if Hillary Clinton can't make this debate or has problems during it, the Democrats will force her out. So this is an incredibly historic time to be alive. It's the final countdown. Here is a very important report I filed last night on this subject. In mid-August, the Secret Service leaked exclusively to Infowars.com that Hillary Clinton was basically having convulsions every hour and falling down if they didn't keep her drugged up. It was at the RNC 3.5 weeks ago when it kicked off that Joe Biggs and I and others were able to talk to the Secret Service quite a bit off record. And we were told that in the next month or so, get ready for some very powerful information concerning Hillary Clinton. And we said, more leaks? More emails? And they said, no, dealing with her health.
So yes, from the source that I was contacted by in the Secret Service, this gentleman came out and said that they know that Hillary Clinton has Parkinson's disease. Now think about that. That makes a lot of sense. The fact that she's had multiple concussions. We've seen the seizure-like symptoms from her where she starts uncontrollably twitching. And that could lead her to fall, which could give her those concussions, which has also led to the blood clots and so forth and so on. So it makes a lot of sense to see how this is starting to unfold.
Then, just 3 weeks later, on September 11th, Hillary Clinton collapsed. The media tried to cover it up, but an amateur photographer actually got the video. In the week after her collapse, the DNC met in New York and DC to decide who her potential replacement would be. Now, the word is that Hillary has canceled any appearances through Monday and is only talking to people via satellite or Skype. No personal appearances. How will she stand up for 90 minutes against Donald Trump when she already had to come out late at one of the previous debates against other Democrats? Will she collapse? Will she have a coughing fit?
Too much to say.
Now that you have the background, here's the new information. Multiple high-level sources have confirmed to Infowars.com that if Hillary Clinton cannot make this debate on Monday, that's scheduled to be the biggest in history with 100 million viewers, that the Democrats are going to try to force her to drop out of the race. She effectively is throwing in the towel if she can't take the field against Donald Trump. Everything is on the line in the countdown over the next 4 days. And Infowars.com will be covering the debate live, taking the feed before, during, and after. Join us at Infowars.com/show or download our new app that has video and live audio feeds, news alerts, you name it, at Infowars.com/app. Everyone, not just Americans, but people across the world are on the edge of their seat. And Infowars is going to be chronicling what unfolds and giving you the inside scoop right through this debate and right through the 2016 historic election. And that is Alex Jones. We'll be right back. All of our major third-party platforms are under massive censorship attack. And Paul Watson has had one of his viral videos shut down. YouTube is announcing that they are going to have socialist brigades of social justice warriors that they actually call hero brigades, military groups, in the terminology they use, who will swarm and complain about things, and then your video will be shut down, you'll be demonetized, or you will be blocked, as Paul Watson's latest viral video
what really happened in Charlotte got hit with in the early morning hours today. And the reason that's important is they've announced their style of censorship. It's the Chinese style. It's where they have these communities that complain about you and who have basically these certifications they're given the more they tattle. And then their boat counts 3 to 5 to 10 times more than yours. But libertarians and patriots, we don't tend to go out and complain about things and try to pull down free speech. They do. So they also have that leg up on us as well. So this is the new model that Facebook and Twitter and YouTube are now officially launching today. Paul Watson has a story about it up on Infowars.com. Here's another one. YouTube gamifies censorship, recruits army of trolls to mass flag videos. And they're going to, quote, fight the trolls with their trolls. And people are emailing Paul, emailing us, saying, we're going to get you. We're going to shut you down. But don't worry. The public schools allow them to put on the Satan Club for your children. After school Satan Club must be allowed to proceed. That's being reported on out of the Associated Press and others. And we have more articles. George Soros is funding Ferguson protest, hopes to spur civil action. The Washington Times, hundreds and millions more have been given. And they now admit, the police have gotten the numbers. We have a report here. 70% at least of the people in Charleston and the people in other areas of the country where we've seen these type of things unfolding in North Carolina and places like Ferguson and all over the nation, they are being brought in by outside groups. So every major city has these people being brought in, where whether it's in Charlotte, North Carolina, or whether it's in other areas, and they're engaging in this type of activity to just stir everybody up. And it doesn't matter if a black guy shoots a black protester, it's white people's fault. It doesn't matter if a black cop shoots a black guy that's got a gun in his hand, it's the white people's fault. But when it is a white person's fault, they get charged with manslaughter. The female police officer that shot the unarmed black man who had his hands up on video because she said she was, quote, scared, has been charged with manslaughter. And I said 2 days ago, and I said yesterday, looks like manslaughter to me. And again, I'm no prosecutor, but if it isn't 100% intentional or you're scared or it's not premeditated, you get manslaughter. And I think that's the minimum charge there. And it's not that I'm out to get the police. It's just that, you know, this is a tough job. I know you get scared. Bad things happen. But you killed this guy. And, you know, quite frankly, this type of stuff goes on where people get out of their car with their cell phone in their hand. The cop instinctively has been trained and shoots them. And I think a lot of this training does save police officers' lives. But at the expense of, you guys are like quick draw McGraw or something, where before I can even blink, you know, you got your guns out. And then you're pulling triggers, and I'm just sorry, you just can't do that. But is this the number one issue in the country? It's been made the number one issue in the country artificially. But it's not statistically, it's way down the line. Third night of protest in U.S. city amid heavy security, Charlotte, North Carolina. Protesters took the streets for a third night in the city of Charlotte on Thursday amid heavy security aimed at preventing more clashes over the fatal police shooting of a black man. Why do they say he's a black man if you don't say it's a black guy that shot him? Hundreds marched to the city police station carrying signs saying stop killing us and resistance is beautiful, but the atmosphere was far calmer than previous two nights. Joe Biggs got tear gas there when he was covering folks that had blocked a road. And, you know, I'd say 60-70% of the people out there are social justice warrior white people that are basically egging the whole thing on and just adding to all the mental illness and the insanity. I see these signs saying white violence must stop. It'll always be some weird woman or some weird white guy. And then some of them are getting beaten up, though, by the KKK-style black gangs that just see white people and they beat them up. Doesn't matter how much you beg, how much you plead, how much you say you hate yourself. You're getting beat up. You're getting thrown in fires. You're getting, you know, drug out in the middle of the street. You're getting your tennis shoes stolen off of you because this is just criminals using this as an excuse to rob stores, rob cars, engage in these types of activities, period. But Paul Watson puts probably his most powerful video out ever. And by the way, Paul Watson's videos end up getting aired on Michael Savage's show that reaches upwards of 6-7 million people a day. They get his pieces get aired on radio stations all over the country, not just here. My pieces do as well. Our other reporters do. We're known in media that you can play our stuff copyright free. Please play it. I just want to get the word out. And so this is a guy that is reaching with his average video. Let's be conservative. 4 or 5 million people that we know of. I mean, he routinely gets 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 4 million, 5 million, 6 million, 7 million. Paul has gotten 10 million views on some of his videos. His record video has 10 million. My record video has 50 million. My next record is 15 million, just on one version of the Obama deception. But the point I'm getting at is mainstream media cannot compete with that and is dwarfed by it. So he puts up a video, The Truth About Charlotte. And what happens? Charlotte riots, what they're not telling you. On the website, it's The Truth About Charlotte. And it gets 249,000 views. You're probably going to get over 1 million. And boom, they won't let you look at it. They put an age restriction on it. This video may be inappropriate for some users. You got to log in. That immediately, most people don't want to do that. It kills it. That's how you kill a video. That's how you censor it. And there's nothing unage appropriate on it. This is all the same stuff on the news, but we show how they are conflicting with each other, how they're contradicting each other. And the point I'm getting at here is I have a stack of news of massive censorship being announced. And it's only against conservatives. It's only against libertarians. It's only against patriots. When you get thousands of, in many cases, racist black people out there randomly robbing and killing and looting with other criminal white people that just want to go out and break stuff, and you've got Rachel Maddow saying, these people are peaceful, this is good, this is terrible, and then never mentioning it was a black cop that's been highly decorated in his community, and his community, I've been reading about him, loves him. He's done a lot of great stuff, community stuff for kids. Guy's got a lot of courage, and there's a black guy with a big criminal record waving a gun around. They tackle him. He's got the gun in his hand. He won't let go of it. They say, drop it, drop it, drop it. Oh, yeah, let's play his brother. Let's play this. I mean, I don't care.
All white cops are devils and white people.
That's right, saying all white cops and all white people are devils. But it was a black guy killed your brother. In fact, let's play that clip in its entirety right now, because this is so important to understand, ladies and gentlemen, that I don't care if it's white trash or black trash. You know thugs when you're in a parking lot with your family. Whether they're white or black, they are Hispanic, they've all got this thuggish, immature look. They're trying to scare you. They're, you know, you got a problem, you want something? I mean, I grew up in Dallas around a bunch of trash, okay? And let me tell you, there was plenty of it of every color. And I'm telling you, it's people that don't work, they're lazy, they're entitled, they think that you owe them something. I don't care what color they were. I could be out in the country at a Dairy Queen with a girlfriend, and you'd see a truck of white trash pull up with 4 or 5, you know, teenage guys in it. And I'd say, let's just get out of here. And they'd come in smart mouthing people, shooting their mouths off. If there were, you know, kind of some black thugs in the store, I saw stuff like that. They'd kind of get along with the white thugs. And then, oh, but they saw one guy with a nice truck and a good looking girlfriend. What are you doing, punk? Yeah, you want something? And back when I was younger, I'd say, listen, let's go outside. I'm going to rip your heads off. There's nothing worse than cowards like you. And sometimes they went outside. But I'm not sitting here saying I'm tough. You get 4 or 5 guys threatening me, starts flipping some switches. I'm skipping this network break. Just like global government and tyranny and forced inoculation flips my switch. So I'm here on air fighting it and effectively fighting it with you, because you've had your switch flipped. But to watch a bunch of spoiled, rotten social justice warrior trash of every, man, I haven't seen really any Hispanics out at this latest thing in North Carolina. But, I mean, there's a bunch of trashy people with their drawers hanging down. You know, do you know what 30, 40 years ago it meant if you had your drawers hanging down over your butt, down below your butt? It meant you were a punk. And in prison, that means a male person that operates as a female who gets passed around and usually gets HIV, by the way. I mean, I'm just letting you know that MTV and the rappers and the culture, as a joke, sold you something. The jail guard, Freeway Rick Ross, you know, the guy that took the name of the real Freeway Rick Ross, he walks around with a big fat belly and his underwear sticking out and his pants down below as a joke on you to get your kids to dress like a sex slave in prison. But see, people think it's cool to walk around with sex slave outfits on, with GIMP outfits on. Bring out the GIMP. gimp sleeping. Well, you just got to wake him up now, don't you? Let's go ahead and play the punk thug brother saying all white people and all white cops are devils. Here it is.
I know. Guys, is there anything we should know? No.
You want to add? Just know that all white people are f***ing devils.
And make sure you air that one.
Air that.
Don't take that
All down. White cops are f***ing devils and white people. Y'all are f***ing devils.
Now, I've got to hand it to him. I mean, he's acting like a thug to me, but his pants aren't hanging down over showing off the goods. I'm going to skip this break. Now, the only one today, though. No others are allowed to be skipped. I'm going to behave myself better. That's a network break. I can do it. We've got all that going on. Meanwhile, Tulsa cop who shot Terrence Crutcher charged with first-degree manslaughter. And I understand she needs to be charged. She clearly, the evidence looks like she did just kill him out of fear. That's exactly what the prosecutor says, is that she panicked and was hysterical. But still, that's manslaughter. Just like Donald Trump said it yesterday, just like I said 2 days ago, you can clearly with common sense see this woman was scared. And it's part of the hype, probably is part of the racism that George Soros is invoking on both sides. That, you know, there's a big black guy running around pissed off in the heat. I'd be mad too. Your car's broke down the middle of the street. That'll get you a little bit hysterical in the middle of a highway when your car breaks down. I mean, I've had a broke down car before trying to change a tire, and a cop pulls up and says, what are you doing? And, you know, you just cut your finger, and I'm like, I'm fixing my tire. Okay, whatever. The point is, I mean, I've been rude to cops before. They've asked me what I'm doing, fixing a car, and I go, what do you think I'm doing? You know, back when I was younger, I've learned to control myself, you know, these days a little bit better, but that's what he reportedly did. She runs up. He's like ignoring her, trying to fix a car, and she goes, get your hands up. And he goes, okay, I'm just trying to fix my car. And she just shoots him. No criminal record, happy father with kids, just got executed. But the point is, statistically, it's incredibly rare, and the cop got indicted. And cops shoot white people, too, folks. White cops shoot white people. A black cop shoot black people, just like we just saw unfold in Charlotte. We see this happen in so many other places. Now, here's the big news. I want to shift gears out of this for now, and I want to get into the debate. And the latest is up on drudgereport.com. For posterity, we are copying this article up to infowars.com as well. Debate rules, no coughing breaks, exclusive. Friday, September 23rd, this broke at 11:30 and 40 seconds Eastern time, so a little under an hour ago. If presidential hopeful Hillary Clinton slips into a coughing fit or any other medical crisis during Monday's high-stakes debate, she will have to power through, the Drudge Report has learned exclusively. There are no commercial breaks, a commission source explains, period. Despite moderator Les Holt does not have the authority to cut away from the stage during the epic 90-minute showdown that's set to have more viewers I should have than the Super Bowl, and microphone audio for either of the candidates is not to be manipulated. Man, finally a real debate. This is awesome. Clinton has experienced severe coughing episodes throughout her election year. Yeah, her last appearance in public was on Monday. She had a coughing fit and just hadn't been seen since. She had a coughing fit at the end. During a Labor Day campaign stop, she suffered again a four-minute choking marathon. And she was in a medical tent for 45 minutes before that. We were there, our reporters. And the media did not pick that up. Monday's throwdown could top out at 100 million viewers, making it the biggest political event in history and bigger than even the biggest TV show, MASH, in its 1983 final show, I should add. Editors note, the Presidential Debate Commission settled an early flashpoint when Clinton demanded a step stool at the podium so she can lean on it to add height to her 5'4 frame. Campaign chairman John Podesta expressed concern that Hillary would be dwarfed by 6'2 Trump. Well, that's just how it looks. You know, go with reality. The request was quickly rejected. The commission is allowing for a custom-made podium, which will accommodate the difference in stature. So she'll have her little podium. It'd be like if I went in a suit shop and said, this suit's for a 6'3 man. I'm only 5'11. I demand you only have suits that are my size. I mean, it's just, it's crazy. Absolutely crazy. And we have Rand Paul. This is on Infowars.com. Steve Watson. Rand Paul questions Clinton's health, says she could have neurological problems. Senator says Americans don't buy dishonesty of Hillary's pneumonia. Yeah, she's been sick far too long. Hillary Clinton slams suggestion she needs neurological test despite bizarre video showing her eyes moving out of sync, pointing the wrong directions. Doctors are now coming out saying, when I said days ago, it's common sense, that's neurological problems. I talked to medical doctors about it. Clinton's eyes, a window into her health issues. Another article out of the Hill, breaking down, it shows she's got serious problems. Voters think Trump has more stamina than Clinton. That's like saying you think the North Pole is colder than, say, Sri Lanka. So a lot of that coming out. We've got new polls showing an even bigger margin of victory for Trump right now. So will they stage false flags? What are they going to do? Are they going to have Soros intensify the Black Lives Matter using any excuse they can to get riots going? We know. He's given hundreds of millions more. The Ford Foundation gave $100 million 3 weeks ago. You're seeing the effects. This is the destabilization program. That's all coming up. But first, talking to our sources, this is very, very, very important. If Hillary does drop out of this or has a bad showing and has problems, the Democrats see this as her make it or break it point, demarcation line. They are going to pressure her to step down. They've already been doing it, asking her if she thinks it's a good idea, but she does really run the Democrats. She is a puppet of the globalists, but in power to a great extent. But the word is, if she doesn't make it, she's 100% out. The DNC is going to move against her. If she has problems, they're going to really push her. And the question is, who's going to come in after that? So the big secret of the Trump versus Hillary debate revealed. It's another report I filed last night. It's up on Infowars.com. But let me add a point here. They're trying to censor us and everybody else that promote liberty because they're losing the fight. And they admit now they're coming in to censor. If we take the giant audience we have and Drudge has and a few other great outlets have, and if everybody promotes those even harder and sends links and sends stories and retweets Drudge's tweets and our tweets and takes our videos and articles and gets them out to everybody, we will break the back of the globalist and they will not be able to censor. But if we self-censor because they're going to start coming in and pressuring us and nudging us, they're going to win. Now is the time for maximum effort. Send everyone you know the link to Infowars.com/show for our live debate coverage. And again, this is going to be pretty much wall to wall. We're not going to be interrupting it except during pauses. We'll have analysis before for an hour and for 2 hours after. That's coming up this Monday, just 3 days out. It's historic. Spread that link, Infowars.com/show. Here is the special report.
It's almost here. You can cut the tension with a knife. The first real debate for 90 minutes, head-to-head, hosted at a university in New York, next Monday at 8 o'clock Central until 9:30 Central. And Infowars.com will be covering it live on the scene and with our own feeds, as well as live commentary and analysis at Infowars.com/show. A few weeks ago, I made the point that this could be bigger than the Super Bowl because the American people are really starting to wake up. And guess what? Top media analysts have now come out and looked at the early numbers coming in, and it appears there could be as many as 100 million viewers. That has never happened in history and will be bigger than any TV show, including the Super Bowl, that the United States has ever broadcast. But I wouldn't hold your breath. Something tells me there's less than a 50-50 chance Hillary's going to show up to this debate. In fact, she's only doing like one event a week and isn't doing any events now right through next Monday. That tells you how incredibly sick she is. And as Trump begins to surge in the polls, you would expect her to be out on the street redoubling her efforts, but she's not. So even if she makes it to the debate next Monday night, how is she going to be able to stand up there for 90 minutes? So I wonder what the numbers are if I was a betting man on her collapsing or having a coughing fit and having to cut the debate short. And don't forget, there's precedents for this. During one of the Democrat debates, they had to pause for like 10 minutes because she wouldn't come out after the, quote, commercial break. Ladies and gentlemen, you talk about edge of your seat. I don't care about sports and stuff like that because it doesn't matter. It doesn't affect my life or my children's future. But this does. I'm proud to see the American people so excited about this debate. And it's because we're finally getting somebody real to go up against the establishment represented by Hillary Clinton. This isn't sports. This is reality. We're not just spectators watching some basketball or football game. We're actually in the arena. This is our country. This is our world. And the sleeping giant is awakening. And InfoWars will be on the field at the event in New York and right here in Austin, Texas, with the live feed and live analysis. Join InfoWars for live coverage of the first debate. kicking off 1 hour before the debate starts at 7 o'clock Central at Infowars.com/show. You can also sign up for our free newsletter, and we'll send links out to you at Infowars.com/newsletter. You can also go to Infowars.com/app and download our new interactive app that has audio, video feeds, special live reports, and so much more. Again, watch the debate on your smart TV or at Infowars.com/show or on the free app at Infowars.com/app. From the entire InfoWars news crew here in Austin, Texas, I salute our fellow InfoWarriors, not just here in the United States, but worldwide. The revolution against global tyranny is being televised. This is the heart of 1776.
And again, the full report is up on InfoWars.com. Hillary to drop out of race if she cancels debate. That's part two of that. I'm going to come back and get to all the big news, the Trump clips, and so much more straight ahead. We've got a bunch of guests today as well. I'm Alex Jones. Now, there's a way to get around the censorship. Once we've already embedded a video that they then block from being shared, as long as you already had it embedded on your webpage, like Infowars.com, it's still able to be seen. We just can't share the video anymore without somebody logging in with credentials to YouTube. And again, if a video had 250,000 views in a couple hours, that means it would have gotten over 1 million views, maybe 5 million, maybe 10 million. You never know, but it was going for 1 million. And then when it gets 1 million, it gets picked up by national news, and then it gets played by national radio shows. I mean, just one example is Michael Savage plays Paul Watson stuff all the time. He's welcome to, like we ask him to. I mean, I don't care if Sean Hannity or Rush Limbaugh did. You can even cut InfoWars off of it and not give us credit. That's why we only say InfoWars visually at the end, so that people that are in competition with us, not so much Savage, but others, don't have to clip us out. Because I don't want any credit. I want to defeat the New World Order. They're coming with forced inoculations. They're coming with for our guns. They're starting wars. They're creating total racial division. It's horrible. They are forcing GMO food on us. They are establishing a private corporate planetary government. There's another Washington Post article out today and a Financial Times of London publication. Those are as elite as it gets for putting out propaganda. Financial Times of London, New York Times, Washington Post, The Economist. All of them in the last few months write articles every few days, but two are out today saying global government is in trouble. The liberal world order is in trouble. We've got to defeat Trump. We've got to prop up Hillary. We're in a crisis. I know I've covered this a lot, but they're back in the news saying it again. And they're saying, we've got to censor these people, and YouTube is upping the censorship. So I want to play this video in a moment. But listen, people say, well, if they're censoring you so much, get out of these electronic ghettos. And Matt Drudge is absolutely right. We've got to visit our own sites. We've got to build our own video sites. We've got to build our own news sites. We've got to build our own TV networks. I'm trying. And when Drudge says that, and he's a smart guy, he's not lecturing. He's telling everybody, don't support Facebook. Don't support, you know, these platforms. And I get that. But Drudge is on Twitter, too. We share his stuff on Facebook. What he's saying is, and I agree, do not rely on them. I use them to get our information out, but more and more we're being censored. And I've had to do stuff like file lawsuits, and I don't want to get into the whole backstory, but there's a reason we're on Facebook. There's a reason we're on YouTube. They know I go get the heavy hitter lawyers, and we start writing the letters, and we go file the lawsuit, and then suddenly the vice president of a company calls you up, and here, let's fix this. Because I'm going to haul you in before a jury. I'm going to show you're violating your terms of use. I'm going to show you're letting people have kill Donald Trump Facebook pages for 2 years and, you know, kill Christian pages and do all this. And then we've got a site simply pointing out real information. And you want to say it's racist, it's hateful, it's evil. But now they want to be able to say, oh, to judges, we have communities. We had thousands of people say this Paul Joseph Watson video was racist. And so, because they say so, you lose your speech. That's called democracy. We're not a democracy. We are a constitutional republic. Let me explain how this works to new listeners. In a republic, we have a representative democracy, a limited democracy, little l. In a pure democracy, if 51% vote to kill the other 49, it happens, or they at least try. Or if 51% votes that another group in the country, let's say some minority group, are no longer humans. They actually had votes in this country back when they operated like a democracy. It violated our republic. People pointed that out. That's why I got overturned later, saying, you know, blacks are two-thirds, so their votes count as two-thirds in apportionment to states in the Electoral College. I mean, this has been done before, okay? So this is the route we're going. So when you hear the Democrats and people pushing, we're a democracy, look out. We have a Bill of Rights and Constitution that says private property, religious rights, on and on and on, is protected no matter what people vote or what people say. And that's being overthrown right now. And they are organizing themselves under leftist cover to absolutely censor, and it's happening. So what do? You don't take our videos and our articles for granted. And by the way, you're not doing that. Thank you. But you redouble your efforts, sending them out to everybody, reposting them, putting them out. Start your own local radio show. Start an access show. Start your own YouTube channel. Because they can't censor all of us. We are winning. We're taking action. But they're trying because we're defeating them. Hillary told Congress 4 years ago, we're losing the info war. Close quote. She came out 3 weeks ago and said, we've got to shut down Alex Jones Darkheart. I mean, that's amazing. We've got to shut down the alt media. Breitbart has no right to exist. And of course, when they're saying that, they know Drudge is way more popular than our sites combined, but Drudge even has a more popular view with people. And by popular, he's even less polarized because he's so reclusive. It's a stroke of genius. In their internal reports and congressional hearings, they say Drudge, 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 Drudge. In the Federal Elections Commission, they say Drudge, 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 Drudge. Talk radio, talk radio. But then when they get ready to try to do it, they go after two of the biggest organizations that are seen as bare knuckles, like Breitbart, Stephen Bannon, and yours truly, Alex Jones. And Paul Watson, they are after him so bad because let me explain something. Almost everyone I know that has high school and middle school students, do you know who they watch every day? And I mean, I go to people's plays. I go to barbecues. I don't even know people. And some 14-year-old walks over. Boy, girl goes, oh, I watch Paul Watson. I learned about you through Paul Watson. Or they say Steven Crowder. Or they say Gavin McGinnis. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, Paul Watson himself has tens of millions of people that watch him every week. Rachel Maddow doesn't have that in a month. So they want to shut us down, okay? And I explained to Watson recently, I said, you're going to just have to move here. He wants to anyways. Now, to be in a big studio with our lawyers, with everything we've got, you've got to go ahead and show folks you're not just at your house with a map behind you, you know, doing a great job, because when we go to court and things, it won't be perceived as evil as it really is. But if it's a major media organization in multi-million dollar studios, we're going to win. And I've already been talking to all the lawyers. I mean, we have to get big or be destroyed. We're already bigger than they are. We have to finally act like we're bigger than they are, because these arrogant crooks know we're killing them politically. So they want to just sit here and waltz in and start shutting down talk radio and taking our sponsors and knocking people out and going after folks and infiltrating organizations and bringing down Fox News. When they brought down Fox News 2 months ago, I told you, get ready. Okay, I've got all this other news, but the point is, censorship's here. It's time to support the broadcast. It's time to support our local AM and FM affiliates. It's time to put up a billboard. It's time to get aggressive. Trump made it okay to be politically incorrect and tell the truth. Everybody now is going through that wedge. It's getting much larger. We're beginning to win. But the enemy is going to counteroffensive, so let's just redouble our efforts now. Everyone should go to InfoWarsStore.com and look at the thousands of shortwave radios, non-GMO seeds, incredible books, films, Molon Labe, Hillary for Prison, T-shirts, come and take it. The best, lowest price organic selenium you're going to find, Bio True Selenium, 20% off Super Male and Super Female Vitality, amazing herbs, high-quality storable foods, the very best gravity-fed filters. They're like four brands, because there's four brands out there that meet mustard. You know, they're really high quality, and we've got the lowest prices. 20% off the best vitamin B12 organic you're going to find, taken sublingually under the tongue every day, the bone and joint formulas, Brain Force, high-quality colloidal silver, and it's the big national brand, private label by us, and we sell it for $5 less than they do. Just, you know, what we're doing. And they know we're doing it. They're cool folks, because we're selling more than they do now. But the point is that this is how we're funding the operation. Incredible sleep aid, knockout, $19.95. The same dose of melatonin that we have in this is the same price with leading other high-quality brands. We have 8 other ingredients like L-tryptophan, valerian root, chamomile, it goes on and on, that give you an incredible sleep. I've been having trouble sleeping lately, and I clicked. I went, I sell a product that I know that when I need it every once in a while, I take. It helps me. I've been taking 2 of these a night the last few days, sleeping like a baby. So I don't even follow my own advice half the time. I'm so busy and so in the fight. Take action today. I mean, a lot of these products are just so incredibly low priced and are total game changers because it's just hiding in plain view. Nobody else goes and gets what's in 9 pills and puts it in the same capsule, just doesn't have filler for the same price as just the melatonin. We do. That's just an example of what we do, folks. InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella sign, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Get a bottle of Knockout. Liver Cleanse is back in. Ozonated olive oil cream is so amazing. The Deep Cleanse Special with the Liver Cleanse back in. Winter Sun, vitamin D3, organic. Lung Cleanse, Prostaguard. Same dose as the leading brand out there. This is what you shoot for. Same dose of organic saw palmetto. Same price or sometimes lower than what it's being sold for, its leading competitor. And then we add a whole bunch of other known ingredients that are known to help the prostate and obviously other glands. I mean, that's what we do. I sit back and I go, I want to totally have the latest cutting edge, the top scientists develop, that's over the top, like DNA Force, or I want to take everybody ignoring common sense and fuse everything together and then massively discount it and totally dominate. But that's what we do. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. But they are censoring us more and more. They're coming after our free speech, and we need your support, your prayers, your help. Finally, speaking of sponsorship, we've had these folks off and on for 15 years. Solutions from Science has a wide array of solar panel systems and other systems, wind turbines, EMP bags, smart LED light bulbs, and more. They're always updating the latest cutting edge at the lowest price. You can find their latest summer sale that's ending. They've extended it for us, summersolarsale.com, and then we're 2 days into fall, 877-327-0365. That's Summer Solar Sale, one word, summersolarsale.com. Solutions from Science are amazing, folks, and they're having a end of summer sale. So take advantage of it today, 877-327-0365, or simply go to their website, summersolarsale.com, and see the informational videos and more from the great folks there at Solutions from Science. Okay, I'm going to stop plugging now. But that's how the world goes around. It's how we fund this operation. And that plug, that two-minute plug, goes like a horse and carriage, or love and marriage, as they would say, with what I just said. We're under attack. We're under censorship. You're under attack. We're fighting they don't shut down our remaining coal plants and double and triple prices again on top of what we already face. We're fighting to get decent trade deals that are at least fair, where they don't have big tariffs on us in China and, you know, we have nothing. We're fighting for the Second Amendment. We're fighting for free speech. We're fighting. And all I'm saying is fight harder, folks. It's animating. It's exciting. It's fun. I can feel the spirit of liberty rising. And a big part of that is supporting the broadcast financially and getting great products you need. It's a 360 win. All right. Let's go ahead and go to Paul Watson's report. It's up on InfoWars.com. The article is titled, The Truth of Charlotte They Don't Want You to See. Charlotte riots, what they're not telling you. Media calls rioting thugs peaceful protesters. Now, I can't send the video link out because it won't play. It's been censored. So they go, oh, it's for children. That's their excuse. And they always do that. It could be like sex if it's liberal, you know, and people naked and it's okay. But none of that on this. No cussing, no nothing. They still block it out. But that kills it going viral. But still, you can share the page we have that it's embedded on. So I'm going to retweet this censored video with the InfoWars page in the next 5 minutes at Real Alex Jones. I'm going to repost it to Facebook and point out it's being censored. And we jump between censored platforms and censored platforms. When YouTube wouldn't let us show you the video of Hillary falling down Sunday night, we went and uploaded it on Facebook. It got like 5 million views. They panicked and had to reinstate our videos. We're hitting them and hitting them hard. We're jumping, like going across lava on rocks, jumping like a cat, you know, and using their big, you know, enemy operations to get into the matrix and wake people up. Let's go to Paul Watson's censored report. Here it is.
Harmonious Black Lives Matter activists staged a peaceful protest in Charlotte last night but were brutally tear-gassed by racist cops. Oh, wait a second. Physically attacking reporters is not a legitimate form of protest. Shooting each other is not a legitimate form of protest. Stealing and looting cash registers from local businesses is not a legitimate form of protest. Trying to set journalists on fire is not a legitimate form of protest. Throwing rocks off bridges at passing vehicles full of families is not a legitimate form of protest. Beating up innocent people in underground parking lots because they're white is not a legitimate form of protest. Smashing up apartment windows where black people live to protest in favor of Black Lives Matter is not a legitimate form of protest. Smashing up buses that poor black people rely on to get to their jobs is not a legitimate form of protest. Looting the Charlotte Hornets team store so you can steal basketball merchandise is not a legitimate form of protest. Stealing sneakers is not a legitimate form of protest. Attempting to hijack cars and terrify their innocent occupants is not a legitimate form of protest. But how did MSNBC report on all this? By calling the rioters peaceful.
The people that are out here protesting, they're hugging and they're like, they're being very peaceful.
We were following this crowd that was largely peaceful.
Mostly peaceful.
We've also seen some sweet scenes of protesters hugging one another and praying. Mostly a group of peaceful protesters.
Peaceful, 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 peaceful.
And that's why 94% of Americans don't trust the mainstream media. What's unfolding in Charlotte is objectively, manifestly, provably not a protest. It's a violent, unjustified riot by criminals, gang members, and thugs. Why is the media giving it legitimacy by still referring to it as a protest? If mobs of white supremacists were looting stores, setting fires, attacking journalists, and shooting guns, would the media call it a protest? But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe all this was completely justified because another racist white police officer killed an innocent unarmed black man who was merely carrying a book. Oh wait, he was actually killed by a black cop.
All white people are f***ing devils.
But what kind of book was he carrying? Paperback? Hardcover? Oh no, it was a 9mm gun. Well, imagine my shock. So a black cop shoots an armed black thug with a criminal record, and then a black protester shoots another black protester. Yeah, must be white people's fault. I guess it's my fault for not checking my privilege. And how did de facto Black Lives Matter leader D-Ray McKesson respond to the riots, the looting, the bloodshed, the mayhem, the violence? By tweeting, "We stand with you," because nothing says justice like destroying your own city and living up to the very stereotype about black people that you constantly complain about. Barack Obama also stands with this group, while billionaire white elitist George Soros bankrolls it to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars. Hillary Clinton has promised to change laws for them. They advocate killing cops. They've inspired mass murderers who have killed black cops. Their ideological guru is a convicted cop killer on the FBI's most wanted terrorist list. They've built an entire movement based around the completely fraudulent narrative that there's a racist war against black people being waged by cops. It's manifestly, provably not true. This is what they're protesting against, while none of them give a damn about this. Thanks to Black Lives Matter, more black people are killing each other because cops refuse to patrol these areas. Black Lives Matter is poison. It's doing incredible harm to race relations in America. It's giving gang member thugs an excuse to carry out criminal rampages. And it's resulting in more black people being killed by other black people. How many more cities need to burn before this reality is realized?
Peaceful, 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 peaceful.
Hillary Clinton has no health problems. Hillary Clinton doesn't fall down. Alex Jones says Hillary Clinton falls down. 4 days later, she falls down in front of everybody with a convulsion. That's Rachel Maddow, the name in deception. Whatever she says, just flip it the opposite, and then you know the truth. And why did they censor that video? Because it was the truth. Because it was said in a polite, focused way. And because it wasn't profane. Because it was on target. Because in 3 minutes, 20 seconds, it destroyed their lies. And they're not going to let us sit there and have free speech. Well, guess what? We knew you were coming with censorship, and that's why we are so evenly distributed over so many different media outlets. Terrestrial radio, terrestrial TV, satellite, foreign global satellite, free satellites, subscription satellites, films, VHS, DVDs, access television, the internet, our own video platforms, our own audio platforms, our own free app, Infowars.com/app. The new app's out. It's free on Droid and on the Apple system. And last time I checked, we haven't checked in a few days, it was number 30 total in the free apps on Apple. Ahead of Google and right behind Xbox. And it was the most searched, fourth most searched news term was InfoWars Live on the Apple system, period. On iTunes, period. So that's what you're doing. Hundreds of thousands of you downloading it. Great. Tell your neighbors, tell your friends, tell your staff, tell your crew, tell random people, hey, go to the App Store, or hey, go to the Droid Store. It's free. InfoWars Live. It's got amazing, uncensored news and analysis. This is a culture war. I want to say something that is one of the most important things I've ever said that I should talk a lot more about, and I'm going to be. The globalists know we can end their lie overnight. That's why they always say, be nice, be calm, don't be angry, don't be upset. They want to keep us in a trance state. If we reach out to people, and we explain that, hey, if you go shop for organic food, pretty soon that's all they'll be is organic because no one's buying the poison food. That's already started to happen. We're starting to win. Hey, if you always boycott companies and groups that use self-driving cars and trucks and factories, and you say, I want to buy a vehicle. I bought a Ford truck about 5 years ago, 6 years ago, because I knew it was one of the last assembly lines that was people running almost everything and that the trucks were known for being much better. Then they quit making that truck on that assembly line, and I heard the truck fell apart and had big problems. I bought the first Ford Raptor when it came out. It was made by people, even had the whole sticker. We need to build a culture like that, ladies and gentlemen. And because it was an earlier one, people knew it, and I've been offered as much money as I bought it for just a few weeks ago. Because people know, oh, that's the one made by humans. That's the one that works so well that doesn't break. That's the one that's so... See, I mean, it's incredible. We build a culture where we value each other, just like fair trade. And then that's how we defeat the system. And we boycott these people. That's why they want controlled economies. They use hype to drive us into these systems of acceptance, and then we, with our own money, build our own prison. Now, I want to play Todd Walther, the Charlotte Mecklenburg Fraternal Order of Police union head, saying 70% of protesters are from out of town. Well, they're not protesters. Most of them are violent idiots that have been signaled by the media that it's good to act like this. These are the equivalent of white and black modern liberal KKK gang members. It's just a gang. The KKK is a gang. This is a race-based gang. It's a joke. And the media tries to cover up all the attacks on white people. It's shameful. How about we don't attack anybody unless they already attack us? The female cop that shot the black guy, she's clearly in the wrong. She just got charged with manslaughter, okay? And I'm not just defending the cops. The point is they want a civil war, people. So let's play where the attacks are really coming from. Here it is.
I've been very proud of our officers, our men and women that are out on the streets. I've been very proud of my members, the Fraternal Order of Police, and their conduct out there, how they're handling themselves. I still say that this is not Charlotte that's out here. These are an outside entities that are coming in and causing these problems. These are not protesters. These are criminals. Protesters fight for a cause. They sit down and discuss it. These are protesters that commit crime. They're criminal. They're out here for a different purpose. They're not here to resolve issues and resolve problems. They're out here for their own good.
All right.
So you're saying that all the people on the streets are not from Charlotte?
Well, I'm not saying all the people, but we've got the instigators that are coming in from the outside. I mean, you've heard reports even last night. They were coming in on buses from out of state. If you go back and look at some of the arrests that were made last night, I can about say that probably 70% of those had out-of-state IDs. They're not coming from Charlotte.
It was like 90% in Ferguson. And listen, we've had our reporters there. Joe Biggs is there. He's coming up later today. This is what happens. This is what's been unfolding. Now I'm going to have David Knight coming in, co-hosting. I'm going to have Leanne McAdoo in. We're going to have a reporter from North Carolina, where he's from. Biggs is from Charlotte. He's going to be on. He got gassed last night because he was there covering people blocking a road. Pray for him. He has a lot of courage. He wanted to go alone to get more done. His videos are up on Infowars.com. But it's a fact that MoveOn.org, George Soros, the Ford Foundation, gave $100 million 3 weeks ago. You're seeing that money. Billions have been given. How did they overthrow Ukraine 3 years ago? Anti-police riots. And are there some bad cops? Is there bad stuff you can show? Absolutely. Does that mean you then overthrow the government and then put in whatever you want and it's some UN globalist system? It's simple. They're discrediting protests right now. When they're done, folks, they're going to hang the dupes out to dry. This is a total setup, and I hope America is smart enough to see through it. Infowars.com/app is where the free app is. They're trying to censor us. The answer to that is to double down, fight harder, and to spread the word.
Will America awaken? Will we take back control of our republic from the globalist? There's only 45 days until the general election. This is the InfoWar.
InfoWars is a testament to resistance. I mean, I'm an average guy from Texas, started my political resistance 25 years ago. Within about 3 years, it's about to be 22 years, within about 3.5 years, I was on local access TV. I was known on talk radio. Then within 20 years ago, I had a job in radio. 19 years ago, it had number one ratings at night. 18 years ago or 19 years ago, it was syndicated on limited syndication. But you couldn't stop me. I was like, I'm on this little syndicator on 10 or 15 stations, and I want to buy time on shortwave. You mean, well, sir, you won't make money. You don't even sell products. I don't care. I'm going to take the money I make off local radio, because I was also a salesman. Some months I was making like $20,000 in sales separate from my own show, and I was out there selling, because I'd take that money and buy shortwave radio and buy cameras and buy computers. I was in a war. You weren't going to stop me. I knew. We had to warn everybody, but I always thought, I'm going to warn everybody, and then these other people are going to rise up and be leaders and defeat it. That's finally happening with Trump. But it ended up that I was one of the main leaders, which I don't even want. It's like crazy. It's biblical. I didn't want it. I would always say, I'm looking for leaders. Who's going to stand up? Where are you? You know, this is happening. Here's the documentation. I just thought I'd alert. We're under attack. The drawbridge is down. Alert. And turned out I had to climb down there and take on the globalists as well. But you know who was right beside me, in front of me, at my heart, and behind me? It was you. It was always you. Just like they say in V for Vendetta, the cop's asking V, he goes, why didn't you take action years ago? And he goes, I didn't have enough people. I was waiting for you, waiting for somebody good on the inside. I was waiting for you, Inspector. The Inspector goes, V goes, yeah, I was waiting for you. But then he says, oh, I must meet with V. At that point, I figure out he's meeting with V. Because we're all V. And they tell us we're just animals and we're soulless and just join evil, big deal, everybody's dumb. But the globalists don't want to be run over. They don't want to be dominated. They want you to sit there and take it. It's not fulfilling to be a slave master. It's not fulfilling to be a slave. Let's really be free and lift each other up. I genuinely don't like seeing this race war stuff. The first day of Charlotte, I ignored it even though it was the top story because I'm sick of it. You know, I don't want to sit there and laugh at these idiots. Or the cry. I mean, it makes me sick. I mean, if you saw a bunch of white people beating up black people because a black cop shot a white person, you'd say that's ridiculous. And it's we have to, you know, they've had Congress people come out and say this is racist against white people and then apologize later. It is a race movement. It's being funded by a guy who uses sociology, no matter where he's at, in Africa, the Middle East, or Europe, Eastern Europe, to play groups off. Catholic against Orthodox, Sunni against Shiite, Tutu against Tutsi. I mean, you know, it's what they do. They admit it. Learn about it. Admit you've been conned. I'm not talking to our audience. I know you've got it. We have a disproportionate amount of black Americans that listen that have got it more than I got it. It's such a parrot. And we need to find those folks. I hear them calling in and give them shows or get them to do shows and get them on air. people say, start a Spanish show to reach out to folks. I want the money. I need the funding. I want to do it. I'm trying. Believe me, we got a lot of stuff on the drawing board. But it comes down to financial support. Go buy the products. Go buy the Super Male Vitality, the X2, the Brain Force, the Lung Cleanse, the Colloidal Silver. Hell, you need it. It's changed my life. You're crazy if you don't have it. You're crazy if you don't share our links and our videos. The entire power structure, up to Hillary Clinton and above, is pulling their hair out that I am a political kamikaze. Telling the truth, committed, and I'm never backing down. And they just don't know what to do. Because if they kill me, it just makes me a martyr. But don't think for a minute I don't think I'm out of the woods. I don't want to die. But my spirit will not let me back down. My flesh is like, you need to back off all the time. You need to stop it right now. But my soul is like, no, you're going in, through, and beyond. We'll be back. Stay with us on the other side with David Knight and more. And I'll be back this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. And then the big debate next Monday.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host this hour. We're going to talk to Harry Dent and his book, The Sale of a Lifetime, How the Great Bubble Burst of 2017 Can Make You Rich. Hey, I'd like to know that because that's about next year, be right on my timeline to get rich. So I'm interested in talking to Harry about this. And of course, he's been known as the demographics guy, but he's talking about something else in this book. He's talking, focusing really on bubbles. Joining us now is Harry Dent. Welcome, Harry.
Nice to be here, David.
You know, when we talk about bubbles, the first thing I think about, for some reason, is the Federal Reserve, you know, because we were sold this whole idea of a central bank because they told us that it was going to stop the business cycle, this destructive business cycle. And they did that a little bit before the Great Depression. So what they have done is taken control of our society, of our economy, but they haven't ended the bubbles just recently. And I want to get your comment on this. Just recently, Janet Yellen, head of the Fed, said she's not going to raise interest rates at this point. And Trump came out and said, well, you're working for Hillary. If he would raise the interest rates, it would have had immediate negative consequences in the stock market, and it would have scared a lot of people. So you're working for them. And, of course, George H.W. Bush accused Alan Greenspan of keeping interest rates high to benefit Bill Clinton. What's your opinion on that? Do you think she made the right decision? Do you think the Fed is manipulating politics like they manipulate our economy?
Well, first thing, there's no accident when the Federal Reserve was created in 1913 that we had the greatest bubble back then in history in the Roaring Twenties, and then the Great Depression to follow it. Mm-hmm. The Federal Reserve prevents recessions, does not allow the economy to rebalance, constantly stimulates through lower and lower interest rates, and that will cause bubbles or make whatever bubbles are happening worse. So the Fed has made the wrong decision from the beginning. She can't raise interest rates now because they've got the economy so hooked on low interest rates and zero interest rates and stock buybacks and all this sort of stuff that they can't afford to raise them at all without the stock market getting in a tantrum and reacting, and then that will reverse the wealth effect they've created. So this whole rally since 2009 has been artificial, and people keep worrying about whether all this money printing is going to cause inflation. And I say, hey, the problem is not inflation. The problem is that we create bubbles even bigger than the last ones, and when those bubbles burst, our economy is going to be in worse shape than ever.
Well, we've got a bubble here, and the question, I guess, is when are they going to hit it with a pen, or when is it going to burst of its own accord, and what do you think is going to happen when that bubble that they have created bursts?
Well, you know, I mean, this chart is a great example. People keep telling me, oh, Harry, we're not really in a bubble, and they give all types of reasons. I say, look, you got to agree that the late 94 to early 2000 tech bubble was a bubble, and everybody agrees on that. Mm-hmm. I said, okay, let's look at this stock bubble versus that one. And of course, they lay right over each other. They look exactly identical. The only difference, this one is stretched a year and a half longer, 6.5 years instead of the normal 5 years, which means it's even more stretched and it's going to burst even harder. So, you know, this is what happens when you make money free. People will speculate. Companies will buy back their stocks. People will feel a little richer and spend more or borrow a little more, but it doesn't create real fundamental growth. Bubbles defeat themselves. So what you said earlier, David, yes, this bubble is going to burst on its own. Governments aren't going to stop lowering interest rates until they feel the economy strong, and this will never happen again. They're not going to stop stimulating. It's going to be that Italian debt crisis hits like Greece did, and they're impossible to bail out. can be the fracking industries defaulting in the United States as oil prices continue to fall, as we've been forecasting for years. China bubble is the biggest in the world. That's going to burst. I look at all the bubbles around the world. In this book, we've never seen such a global bubble, and we've never seen it in all sectors, commodities, stocks, you know, emerging markets, developed countries, real estate. It's everywhere. And we've got a whole bubble model that says, look, these are not black swans when they burst. They build exponentially, predictably over a certain number of years. And then when they peak, they're going to correct. Stocks are going to correct twice as fast as the bubble burst. And usually in the first 3 months, the stock market will make half of that big crash. So the people that wait to see if the bubble's going to burst is going to be too late. We tell people, get out now. We're getting close. By you know, we have this election coming up that's going to be volatile for the economy at first. But I think the big thing is now that the Fed did pause and did not raise in September, they're going to have to raise in December or look like they're never, ever going to raise and lose credibility. And Italy is going to be a default problem by early next year. And there's no way Europe can deal with that. No way.
Wow. Now you're talking about people not being able to see the bubble. I want to, if you guys can get a document cam here of an illustration out of Harry Dent's book here, Why We Can't See Bubbles. And so you've got a bell-shaped curve here, and you say we're at different points in this bell-shaped curve, as it's going up, people are very optimistic. They say we won't have any recessions anymore. We get to the top and it levels out and it gets kind of soft and it's not doing anything, and even maybe a little bit of a downturn, people say, well, it's going to be a soft landing. But you pointed out, as you just said, people are going to see the massive amount of value lost in just a short period of time. And that's what you see with this bubble, a massive fall off that is far worse than anybody said. Then you get to the trough and people say things are so bad, they'll never improve. I'm old enough to have seen this many times on many different issues. That's absolutely, that's a perfect illustration.
And, you know, David, real quick, what's behind this, and this is something we address in this book and all of my books, but especially in this book, we want to think that things go up linearly and incrementally and just get better, 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 and then you kind of go to heaven and stay there. Life, everything goes in cycles. And so we're projecting in straight lines. And so that's why the better things get, the better we think they're going to get. A smart investor understands the longer a market goes up and the higher it gets, the more downside and risk there is. And again, when it starts to flatten out, we say, oh, well, the government will do this or this will happen and we'll have a soft landing. We're just projecting the slowdown in a straight line. And then when it starts heading down and gets deeper, we say, oh, my gosh, it's going to go down further. This is human nature. We're really good at a lot of things, David. We're terrible at forecasting. It's because we don't accept the ups and downs and the good and bad of life. We want all the good, all the boom, but none of the bust. And that's what the Federal Reserve wants. The Federal Reserve wants us to grow at 3-4% a year with 1-2% inflation and never have a recession. That would be the worst thing that could ever happen to economy, because the economy actually works off the opposite dynamics of boom and bust and inflation and deflation and innovation and creative destruction. That's what free market capitalism is about. The central banks have destroyed free market capitalism by taking over the markets and setting interest rates and asset prices. And special interests have taken over democracy because they now decide who gets elected or not, and all the money and stuff. They shouldn't be able to have these super PACs and stuff and influence primaries and elections. So we need a big reset, and we're going to get one. And my indicators say, and I got four powerful indicators that all point down in the next 3 years together, which only happened in the mid-70s and that giant crash, and in the early 30s, the Great Depression. So basically, this is destined to happen. And no, I don't care who gets elected, nobody's going to be able to prevent this next bubble burst. The bubbles always burst of their own extremes. It doesn't matter what causes them. The difference is, in this book, I can map out bubbles in different stages, tell you where you are approximately and how much downside there is, and how long it's going to take, because bubbles are actually quite predictable.
You know, one of the bubbles that you mentioned is the China bubble, and you talk about that in depth in your book. You talk about the fact that they are looking at an aging demographic that is even worse than our baby boomer demographic, as well as, and of course, we're also aware of what they've done with their real estate market, ridiculously inflating that. So both of these trends that are very disturbing in the U.S. market are even more disturbing in the Chinese market. I remember economists going back and drawing parallels to the Great Depression and saying, you know, at the time, The preeminent economy was the British economy, and America really was a secondary economy, but we were growing very quickly. Kind of the situation that you still see with the U.S. and China, where they are, we're still kind of the older but more predominant economy, and they're the ones that are growing rapidly. And it's when that rapidly growing upstart has a problem and a burst that it really brings on the greater depression. Is that what you see happening with the China bubble bursting?
Yeah, let me give you an example. I mean, China is the greatest bubble in modern history precisely because the government is driving their economy from the top down, centrally planned. Now, that's not socialism. That is communism. Mm-hmm. That's what failed in Russia. And we didn't learn, or at least China didn't learn the lesson from that. The Shanghai market, which you show, the real estate market, has gone up 8 times, 900% since 2000. Our real estate market went up 2.3 times and then crashed 34%, and it's got more to go. So you can't even compare these bubbles. China has 250 million people they've pushed in the last two decades into urban areas, and they're not even registered citizens. They got low skills. They're building stuff for nobody. That's what China's government does. They force and guarantee loans down at the local levels, and then the local communist governments give contracts to crony businesses to build stuff for nobody, to keep taking these people in from the rural areas. That's how they're growing so fast.
They've got these massive ghost cities that nobody even lives in. I mean, what? That's an absolute perfect example of a centrally planned economy for the benefit of cronies within that who are doing the planning, isn't it?
It is. It's not just in. They do have empty cities, up to a million sitting empty. But worse than that, in their major cities, 27% of the condos or homes are empty. They're on electricity and not using any. So this is an independent survey. You can never listen to the government in China. They'll never tell you the truth. And so they've so overbuilt, it's crazy.
All right, we got to go to a commercial break. We're talking to Harry Dent. His book is Sale of a Lifetime, How the Great Bubble Burst of 2017 Can Make You Rich. We're going to be right back with more of Harry Dent. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show this Friday, September 23rd, 2016. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Harry Dent about his book, Sale of a Lifetime, How the Great Bubble Burst of 2017 Can Make You Rich. And in the very first paragraph, let me read you what he says in the introduction here. He says, some call me the demographics guy. Others call me that crazy guy. But at the heart of it, I'm a cycles guy. And we're in a time of extreme cycles. It's the times that are crazy, not me. And I think that's an interesting way to start the book because, Harry, you have written a lot about demographics, and there's a lot of demographics information in this book as well. But you can't separate these things. They don't exist independently of each other. You know, the demographics drive cycles and so forth, and there's a lot of things that drive the cycles. You talk about past bubbles. You talk about cycles that are coming through here. And finally, you talk about profiting from it. I'm looking at this, and it's like, okay, with everything crashing, how do we make money out of this? And let me ask you, too, about the time frame. Tell us why you're saying that this is going to happen in 2017, because this year we saw massive decreases in oil at the beginning of about a year ago or whatever, and continued to go down. But now oil is going back up. We've seen gold go up about $200 this year. Why are you certain of the time frame of 2017, and how do we profit from this?
Well, number one of the key indicators I've discovered in the last so many years, Ned Davis was a cycle guy, very good guy, who had this decennial cycle that said, you know what, most of the big stock crashes and recessions or downturns or crises come in the first 2.5-3 years of every decade. And I tell you, that worked like a charm in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and early 2000s. But it didn't work in 2010 to 12 when it should have. And so when something doesn't work, I say, hey, what's wrong? And what I found is what's behind that cycle is sunspot cycles, which may average 10 years, but they come anywhere from 8 to 13, and only the best scientists can predict these things. So now I study these scientists. And this, basically, the last sunspot cycle was very stretched, and we had two major crises, the tech wreck and then the great financial crisis, 2008, 2009, in the down cycle of the last one, which was extraordinarily long. And then we had this up cycle. And then in 2014, it turned down again, as the scientists predicted. And ever since, the stock market's gone down. I mean, gone nowhere, with more volatility. Now, this cycle points down for the next 3 years. And of course, the last 3 years of this cycle, as predicted by scientists,
should be the worst. So 2007 to 19 is when the greatest danger period is. Our demographic cycles point down into 2020 before they flatten out and don't turn up for a few years after that. Our geopolitical cycle since 9/11 still points down into early 2020. And our innovation cycle with the peaking of the internet and Moore's law and computers has peaked and doesn't turn around for a long time. So all of our cycles point down at the same time, but it's this sunspot cycle that most allows us to pinpoint danger periods, and that is 2017 to 19. Also, I mean, they've stretched this so far. Yes, the markets have no longer been going up in the last few years, but they're not going down because of endless stimulus. Well, again, I'm just waiting on one thing to go wrong, like an Italy default or a threatening default in Italy, or this Chinese. I mean, the Chinese stock bubble already started to burst in 2015. And guess what? It was down, just like typical, 45% in the first 3 months, even though it's eventually going to be down 80 or 90%. But that China bubble's been propped up by the government buying their own stock market. It's only gone sideways. When that next leg drops on stocks, then the Chinese investors are going to worry about real estate. And you saw that real estate bubble earlier. Chinese have 75% of their net worth in real estate versus 28% in the U.S. Their real estate is so overvalued compared to their economy, compared to ours. When that bubble bursts, it's going to take the entire world down. It's going to make the subprime crisis in the U.S. last time around look like nothing. So we're just waiting for something to go wrong. I'm just telling people, look, the stock market now is fighting headwinds, even in all of our cycles. And when something finally goes wrong, the first wave down is going to be down 30, 40, 50% in a matter of months. You're better to get conservative now. The key to what you first asked, how do you take advantage of these big crashes? You have to protect your money now. You have to take your money out of these bubbles in real estate and commodities and stocks. And note, these bubbles don't all peak at the same time and they won't bottom at the same time. So commodities have already largely crashed. Oil's already been down 80%, iron ore 80%, steel. Overall commodities are down 70%, corn's down 70%. They may have some more to go, but those bubbles are probably going to bottom earlier. Stocks will come next and in emerging countries first, and then down the road in real estate. Real estate takes the longest for bubbles to burst and to turn around. So we're going to be looking, we look in this book, but I'm going to be looking in my newsletters and stuff. When is the time? When have we erased enough of these bubbles that you can invest long term again? And that brings us back to the bubble models.
We'll have to stop there. We're out of time. Fascinating book. And if you want to know how to get rich, we didn't have time for him to tell us all of it. You can get the book Sale of a Lifetime by Harry Dent. Thank you so much, Harry. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Friday, September 23rd, 2016. I'm David Knight, and we're going to have an interview with Joel Gilbert, who wrote Dreams of My Real Father and There's No Place Like Utopia. He's also the guy behind the massive Times Square billboard that that got millions of dollars of publicity for $25,000. I did Donald Trump as Superman. Got so much attention. Absolutely amazing. Now he's got a viral video called Amerophobia. We have an article about that up at Infowars.com. We're going to be talking to him in the next hour. He's going to describe for us what Amerophobia is and how Hillary Clinton is suffering from it. We also have a clip that we're going to play in just a moment of an interview that Alex Jones had just a day or so ago with William Binney, talking about the real role of the NSA. And of course, William Binney was the technical head of the NSA for decades, and he was one of the key whistleblowers right after 9/11. William Binney, Thomas Drake, and others were very key whistleblowers, and it was looking at what they said and how the U.S. government, specifically the Obama administration, went after them. Because it wasn't the Obama administration, it was the Obama administration that went after Thomas Drake, trying to put him in jail for decades, saying that he had emails and documents that were not classified, but they should have been classified, and he should have known that they should have been classified. Does that sound familiar? Except that the documents that he had were nothing at all, and they were not classified. And they did drop that. It was totally made up, but that's the amazing double standard. But when Ed Snowden saw the way they treated Thomas Drake, that's when he did what he did the way that he did it. It was because of what he saw. And you can see that in the Snowden film. And, of course, William Binney was not only former technical head of the NSA, but he was also a consultant to Oliver Stone on the movie Snowden. Excellent film if you haven't seen it. Take people who don't understand what this is about. Take them to that film. You will have an amazing conversation afterwards. Hopefully, it'll enlighten them as well. In the film, they show you Ed Snowden's life, and probably, like me, you don't know too much about Ed Snowden's life. And it's interesting to see some of the details of his life. But as they're going through his journey and his awakening, they show you how, basically, as you walk through him in a dramatic film like this, that becomes your awakening as well. Walking you through the things that he experienced on the inside, you see what the real danger is. That's my hope. I think people will wake up if they see this film. It's an excellent film, very close to, so close to what is going on right now and the essence of what is going on. It's very important. So we're going to play a clip for William Binney. Before we do, real quickly, I want to remind you that we have extended again the sale for Supermail Vitality, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. This has been extended for our listeners. You know, we do these products trying to make it a win-win situation. We're trying to offer you the best products we can, the best nutraceuticals that we can find. You can read the reviews there. Other people agree with that as well. If you look at the number of five-star reviews, just the number of reviews that we have in general at our website, you can see what other people say these things are doing for them. But we want to offer you products that are going to help you, help your health, protect you from the contaminants that are in the environment. And it's the way that we fund ourselves, independent of big corporations that could pull the plug on our operation at any given point. So it is a win-win situation. And to thank you, we have extended this sale for Supermail Vitality, 20% off. We have extended that now. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, ending very soon is the 20% off Secret 12. That is our high-powered vitamin B12 formula. It's in a liquid form. It's very easy to assimilate when it is liquid, easy to take. Not another pill that you have to take. It's a super formula that combines two ultra bioavailable forms of B12 into a single bottle. And you can see there's over 1,000 reviews on our website of that. 4.8 out of 5 stars when people talk about it. So again, our sale on B12, Secret 12, 20% off, and Supermail Vitality, 20% off. You can see those both at InfoWarsLife.com. Let's go to the William Binney clip now. There's an article that we have up on InfoWars.com. Whistleblower says, and that's what that's another capacity of William Binney. He's been former technical head of the NSA, whistleblower and consultant himself to the Snowden film. He says the NSA is the backbone of world surveillance state. Here's that clip.
What about a larger plan? I mean, I know it's about looting and making money, hundreds of billions of dollars, you know, globally a year by these companies. But what's the master strategy on building this technocracy? I mean, do they have one?
I think it's this is my impression. Okay. Certainly it is population control, but not just of any given country, but of the world. And so what they're after in direct, and I think the Obama has stated this from various points, that he wanted a world community. So I think that's probably what they're after. In order to do that, they have to be able to control the people of the world. So in order to do that, you have to have knowledge of them to know who's doing what so you can stop it or manipulate it any way you want.
William Binney, that is the most profound thing I think I've ever heard you say, and you've said a lot of profound things. This is the key for a technocracy world government program, and Davos admits that's their plan, but here you are, the former leader of the National Security Agency, telling us that that's what they're building, a beast system. If you're not a Christian, it almost makes you one, doesn't it?
Yeah, amazing interview. You need to watch that interview as well that Alex had with William Binney. William Binney always spot on. He understands this better than anybody, and he is an honest patriot. He and people like Thomas Drake and the other NSA whistleblowers, they were concerned about the Constitution. They were concerned about individual liberty. And one of the things that William Binney said in the interview with Alex Jones, another reason you should watch it, I don't have a clip of that, but he talked about how it's becoming mercenary, how it is being outsourced to corporations. And, of course, that was one of the key things at the time that they left. They said, look, we've got a program that was written by people who worked for the NSA. We've got a program that will go through and find people that are dangerous and narrow this search down. But you went outside of the NSA and you paid a tremendous amount of money to a corporation that gave you a system that, if it works, creates a bigger haystack to try to find that needle in. And you're actually making it more difficult to find people. And you spent a great deal of money to do that. And it was in that struggle that, you can see Forrester gets demoted and he's in the Snowden movie. But it's through that struggle that they gradually began to realize some of the other issues and the dragnet surveillance. It was by making that haystack larger, they also violated the Constitution. And so when they're outsourcing this increasingly to private corporations, and of course, Ed Snowden was working for one of these private corporations that they outsourced it to. As they do that, understand that what is happening is that you're getting a mercenary intelligence system. People who were for sale to the highest bidders. And it's replacing citizens and patriots who are working for the NSA. You understand? It's like the army. I'm concerned about a standing army, and I don't like a draft either. I don't want people being forced into military service. Perhaps the best example would be something like they have in Switzerland, where you have some required training. What they're doing in Switzerland is they're creating a citizen militia. They have people there who know how to use firearms. You have required training, but they don't necessarily enslave people, and they certainly don't send their troops off to fight in foreign wars. Switzerland doesn't do that. That's one of the reasons why they've been isolated in peace even during World War II. They had a citizenry that was capable of defending itself, and they set up those borders there. But when you go from a militia and a citizen army to a professional army that becomes increasingly mercenary, that's how they can use them for these different purposes. And if you, it gets even worse when you talk about a professional mercenary intelligence system, because now those people can come in and they can be more interested in looking at emails of people who might give them insights into the stock market or grabbing corporate secrets from all over the world, things that would personally enrich them. And not only that, but because their fundamental loyalty is to the almighty dollar or gold or the franc or whatever it is that they can cash it in at the given time, because they're mercenaries, they're not interested in protecting you. So this whole thing that is being sold to us, that you have to give up your freedom for the promise of security, goes away, doesn't it? And of course, it was a lie to start with. To the degree that you give up your freedom, you become a slave. And they always want to come in and say, oh, just a little bit of slavery, just a little bit of slavery. But it's an incremental bargain. And to the degree that you're a slave, you're not free. You will never be free. Slaves are never free. Slaves are never safe. They are never protected. They're never prosperous. Okay? So to the degree that you give up that freedom, to the degree that you enslave yourself to the system because they promise you that they'll make you safe or you'll be more prosperous or whatever, to that degree, you become a slave, and slaves are never free. Slaves don't own anything, as a matter of fact. And when we're talking about that, I think, you know, when we look at the global system, we've seen a lot of stories, and this is accelerating in this last week, because the federal government has come in and said, we're going to regulate these self-driving cars. We've talked about the technology behind it before. We've talked about the lie that these things are so safe that nobody is ever going to die again from an automobile accident. You know, when I look at that line that's being sold by Volvo and other people like that, I remember when nuclear power was sold to us and we were told it's going to be so cheap, you won't even have to put electric meters out there. And don't worry about any of the safety issues, okay? There are always issues with any technology. But when we started seeing this last week, the kind of articles that are coming out about self-driving cars, what you need to understand is that this is now becoming very quickly about Agenda 21, about Agenda 2030, those UN agendas where they want to keep you in the city. How are they going to keep you down on the farm once you've seen Gay Paris? How are they going to keep you locked downtown after you've seen the suburbs and the exurbs and the rural areas that you would prefer to live in? Because people typically don't like to be packed into little tiny boxes like rats. But that's what Agenda 21, Agenda 2030, the agenda for sustainable development that's being sold to us by the UN. They want you to live closely packed into the cities in little 200-square-foot apartments. And of course, we've seen the map of the United States where they have the areas where people are going to live, a few mega cities, and the rest of the United States where it's off limits. And you might ask yourself, well, they could never keep us out of there. Well, it's all about transportation. And when you look at these stories that have come out, here's a couple that are on Drudge Report today. Bloomberg, robot rides may force error-prone human motorists off the road because, you know, we're dangerous and the cars are just perfect. They say new rules for the road for robot cars coming out of Washington this week could lead to the eventual extinction of one of the most defining archetypes of the past century, the human driver. See, because cars should not serve, what they're really telling you is cars should not serve the needs of the public. Cars should serve the needs of the globalist few. People like Lyft, people like Uber will control all transportation, working with the government as their chosen partners, because the government sees this as the way to keep you tied down, to shut off your mobility, and then when you do have it, to tax and tax you and track you everywhere you go. But understand also that the government wants to participate in this. As they point out in Bloomberg, they say regulators are accelerating the shift. Yeah, they're accelerating the shift. See, this isn't even regulatory capture. This isn't even the kind of crony capitalism that we've seen in the past. This truly is Agenda 21, Agenda 2030. Because what they want to do, and it is the essence of their business model. And I talked about this on Monday night's Nightly News. There was a blog post that was put out by the co-founder of Lyft, the current president, John Zimmer. And in it, he spent so much time, he said it was the third transportation revolution. The first one being trains, the second one being the car as we know it, and the third one being what I would call toll cars. Do you like toll roads? I don't like toll roads. As a matter of fact, toll roads, people dislike toll roads so much that the toll road that they put here in Texas is going bankrupt. But this is not a state story when we talk about toll roads. This is a national story. Because this toll road, the bankers who backed it, and the foreign corporation, Centro, which is a Spanish corporation that owns it, and owns many of the toll roads throughout America. As a matter of fact, in North Carolina, where I came from, that same company is trying to do the same deal in North Carolina, even as this one here is going bankrupt. And they play games. You may not realize, if you don't look at this, the games that are being played. Here in Texas, as they built that toll road, you may have heard they got the speed limit up to 85. Well, that was on the toll road. And just as crony capitalists always do in these private-public partnerships. Partnerships. You know, like Trans-Pacific Partnership, the Transatlantic Partnership. It's when the government and multinational corporations get together and they do something wonderful. They consolidate their wealth and power. They shut you out. They turn you into a renter because they're going to own everything. So you're going to rent the roads, but they've got an even better plan for you. You're not even going to have your own car. You're going to rent the road and the car from them. And one of the things that they do, that they did here in Texas, they raised the speed limit up to 85 on the toll road. And at the same time, they worked out a deal with the Texas Department of Transportation to lower the speed limits on adjacent roads from 65 to 55. How's that? So you'd try to force you onto their road. Not only that, but they got a deal put in where they banned any improvements to the adjacent roads and any new construction, adding any new roads around there. And then they also have traffic lights over and over and over again on feeder roads around. They've increased the number of traffic lights, dropped the speed limit, so forth and so on. But you know what? People still won't ride these things. Many people like me object to them on principle. So what they are doing is they're going out of, they're going bankrupt, and they're taking this system, the bankrupt system, is really underwritten more by federal loans than it is by state loans. So even if you're not in Texas or North Carolina or New Jersey or New York, you're going to pay for those as well. But that is the model of ownership. I've got Alex on the phone right now. Alex, go ahead. Oh, okay. He was on the phone and we just lost him. But as we look at this, what I was going to say about the transportation revolution, he really wasn't talking so much about transportation, but he was talking about cities. And you have to understand, this is why I say this is about Agenda 21 and about Agenda 2030. As you look at this blog post from the Lyft co-founder, president, The vision that you get from him and the vision you get from all these people are that cities are wonderful. We should all be living in the cities. And you know what? If you like cities, that's fine. Go ahead and live there. But they want to coerce you into the cities. And so to do that, they tell you that cars are the problem. So cities are the solution and cars are the problem. No, we have known throughout history that cities have been the center of plagues, of disease, of oppression, of overcrowding. Thomas Jefferson said they're a plague to the health, the wealth, and liberties of man. No, cities are the plague. Cars are the solution. The suburbs are not a problem. People went there to escape the city. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we've got Alex Jones on the line. He heard me talking about self-driving cars, and he's actually on the road, but he's not in a self-driving car. He's actually driving the car himself. Joining us now is Alex. Go ahead, Alex.
Well, absolutely. You know, we attack these self-driving cars because they're constantly crashing and having problems, and they tell us they're perfect. But the globalists admit, as you said, it's about taxing us by the mile. It's about taking humans out of their environment, basically capturing us, totally controlling us, making us be domesticated. Everything that we see is about not having lemonade stands, not having Amish, not having farmers markets. I'm starting a movement in the next few weeks, and even a foundation, where we're going to basically start putting labeling on, saying humans were involved in its productions, humans delivered it, humans actually, were paid for being involved in it. The globalists.
That's a great idea.
Back to Malthus. Can you hear me, David?
Yeah, that's a great idea. I was going to say better than made in the USA, made by humans.
Absolutely. Yeah. So going back, it's not that we're against technology. It's that the globalists admit, going back to the time of Malthus, almost 300 years ago, he said everybody will be in compact cities. It'll be horrible. They're all subhuman. They'll all die. You know, the world will collapse by 1800. It didn't happen. And so eugenics then got picked up. And that's all this is Rahm Emanuel's brother, you know, saying we're going to have a monopoly and you won't even be able to drive your car. It'll be our software. It'll be our cars. This is a group of criminals trying to regulatorily take over and then just take humans out of the equation completely and put us into this, you know, automated control grid. But the answer is exposing what it is. You know, they come out with arrogant statements like within 5 years, you know, the feds say they're going to make the roads only for driverless cars. Well, we're not going to let them do that. Okay, we're going to say no to this. We understand it. But they try to make it sound like you will be assimilated. We are the Borg. Nothing can stop us. This is the Borg. So AI that is globalist directed and monopoly driven, just like they staged the stock market and the interest rates and the currency rates, must end. That's what William Benny said yesterday. Not just that there's a global surveillance grid. He said it's a global government. The surveillance grid is the corporate world government. A corporate world government is financing the surveillance grid, getting all the countries to tie into it to, quote, have this surveillance power, giving rings of power to the dwarves, the elves, and to the men who lust after power beyond anybody else. But then in secret, he forges one ring to rule them all, and in the darkness bind them. This is the beast system. It is the technocracy. We're not against technology, folks, but we're against, just like we're not against guns. Or against how this is being deployed and who wields it. David, you're doing a great job. God bless you. Back to you.
Thank you, Alex. And, you know, when you talk about one ring to rule them all, it's one technology to bind them in the cities. You know, we can talk about the privacy issues. We can talk about the safety issues. But when I look at this, and as Alex mentioned, the article that's up on the Drudge Report, human drivers could soon be banned from the roads. And this is a very specific road, Interstate 5 between Seattle and Vancouver. This is what the politicians want to do. And they will be able to cut you off and keep you in the cities if we allow them to do it. This is why it is very important for us to understand where the long-term plan is for this. We've talked about Agenda 21 for so long. They changed the name. They changed it to Agenda 2030. They got more specific. They said, you know, Agenda 21 was just the 21st century sometime. Now it's 2030. And they talk about it being sustainability. It hasn't changed. They've just put a more firm time frame on it. But understand that the issue is to keep you in the cities. And one of the ways that they do that is to say, well, we're not going to let you have cars in the city. One of these articles where it said, only there's going to be a lot of cities that are going to come in, and the only cars that they will allow will be self-driving cars. And then two paragraphs down, they say, well, a lot of these cars won't be able to drive very well. They won't drive very quickly. They won't be able to drive in bad weather. So what will you be doing? You'll be walking in bad weather. They're going to narrow the roads. They're going to widen the sidewalks. They're going to keep you on foot and locked in the cities. That's the plan. If you understand it, you can fight it. Stay with us. We're going to come back with Joel Gilbert. We'll be joining us in the next hour. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In the next segment, we're going to be joined by Joel Gilbert, documentarian, author, and he has a new viral video we're going to talk about, Amerophobia. And you can see the article at InfoWars.com. A very, very funny video, but we're going to talk to him about the whole concept of Amerophobia. There's a very famous person that suffers from it. As a matter of fact, quite a few people suffer from Amerophobia in the public eye. But in this segment, before we come back with Joel Gilbert, I want to finish up on what I was talking about with the Agenda 21 aspects. And of course, the thing that really troubled me is to see how quickly this is coming. I think they're accelerating this quickly enough, and people don't really understand what is behind it. And now they've got a very specific 150-mile stretch of Interstate 5 between Seattle and Vancouver. And they're saying that they're going to ban that from humans. It's going to be a driver-free zone. They're going to ban human motorists from carpool lanes on this in this area. And that's the way it begins, folks. I think one of the things we need to understand is we need to stop calling these things self-driving cars. You know, an automobile was self-mobility. That's where the name comes from, right? It was about self-mobility. And we controlled it ourselves. And so we go back to this whole idea that the Lyft president was trying to sell us. You know, first we had trains, but then we got autonomous capability to go wherever we wanted to go without the government really having any control over that. And they don't like that for a number of reasons, obviously. Okay, they're desperate to try to put us back into trains, even if that means that the trains are going to be controlled on a literal information highway, that they're going to have the highway and the cars all linked together. They're telling us that they're self-driving cars. And I thought, you know, we need to come up with a better pejorative term that we can use, something that describes it better and that is also pejorative. So I thought, well, you know, botmobiles. No, that sounds too much like a Batmobile. That's just too cool. I think we should call them toll cars because that's the way they're going to be used. So within this last week, as the federal government came down on their side, doing the same thing for these companies that they did for the big agri companies, you know, we had all these different state regulations that were coming up. Said, you know, we want to know if there's GMOs in the food and the products that we've got here. So we're going to mandate that there's labels put on there so people can make those decisions. And if the industry wants to put GMO and genetically modified things inside your food or other products, then sell us on the benefits of that. Tell us how that's a good thing. Don't hide the fact that it's there. Okay? So they were enacting state legislation, or at least fighting them all across communities all across the United States. So what'd they do? They went to the federal government and they said, let's shut this thing down. In violation of the Ninth Amendment, in violation of the Tenth Amendment of the Constitution, they came out and said, you know what? And we've called it the DARK Act. It was passed by Congress. Obama signed it. And what it says is you can't have legislations telling people that mandate that people have to know what's in their food. They shut that whole thing down. That's what they're doing with cars right now. As people started having experience with these cars, they saw some of the safety issues. They realized that they were being sold a bill of goods on the safety issues. Then some regulations started coming along in various communities, especially in California, because they were the first ones to see the self-driving cars. They saw the number of accidents. Now we've seen several people, at least a couple of people die in these self-driving Tesla vehicles. And remember, the guy who died here in America, they covered that up with the assistance of the federal government for 2 months while they played the stock market. Now the SEC is investigating it. He's being sued by stockholders because that was a very negative thing for them. They were touting the autopilot feature as a big selling point. And then when somebody dies, they cover that up. They've covered it up in China for 8 months. There was somebody there in China who died in self-driving mode. And they've covered that up for 8 months. And remember, they lied to us when it first came out. They said, oh, it wasn't in self-driving mode. Well, it turns out it actually was. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk to Joel Gilbert. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Friday, September 23rd, 2016, Monday, the big debate. And of course, we're going to be covering it live here at InfoWars. It's not a sports event, but there's a lot of analogies that could be drawn to it. We're going to talk about that later. But if you want to think of it in a sporting terms, okay, we're going to have live commentary. We're not going to get in the way. We're going to be carrying the actual debate here, but we will have some comments on the side, kind of like commentators do for the football games occasionally. But we will also have instant replays when there's something very big. And I think this is going to be a momentous event. Everybody is talking about it. Everybody is looking forward to it. And again, we're going to be covering that live Monday night here on the InfoWars Nightly News. Now, joining us now is Joel Gilbert. We talked to Joel about a week ago because of the viral billboard campaign that was going on in Times Square. Joel had a billboard that they had purchased for, I think it was about a week in Times Square, New York City. He can correct me if that's wrong. It was a digital billboard that was animated. And they did a kind of a cartoon meme there of Donald Trump as Superman, pointing out how he's jetting all over the country, essentially. But, you know, not even making that point. I mean, it was just a visual. It didn't say anything, but it went viral. They only spent $25,000 on it. They got millions of dollars of publicity. People all over the world were contacting Joel and saying, what is this about? And he got to talk to them about why he would choose to put Donald Trump in there as Superman. But he's got another viral video, and that's what we want to talk to him about today. This is up on InfoWars.com. You can see the video linked there. The title of the article is Hillary Clinton Promotes Amerophobia. And so we want to talk to Joel about this latest viral video. Thank you for joining us, Joel.
Hey, great to be back. Thank you.
You know, the left is always saying you're this phobic and that phobic and so forth and so on, right? I mean, phobia was a psychological term, said you were afraid of something or you disliked something or whatever. So this is a great idea because we've got people who are afraid of America, who hate America. And so tell us a little bit about Amerophobia. You know, what are these Amerophobes like? What do they believe? We'll just go down your points here in the article that you wrote here.
Okay, thanks. Well, we all saw the recent attacks on the American people by Barack Obama when he was in Laos. He told his audience that Americans have a latent racism gene and that when we're low on cash, we become xenophobic. We start to dislike other people and people around us when we get low on cash. We saw Hillary Clinton's attack on half of America by saying that Donald Trump supporters were xenophobic, Islamophobic, homophobic. It's like one long word of phobias. Now, the left is very comfortable smearing people, saying they have a mental disorder. And it goes back in history a little bit because it really started in Stalinist Russia when Stalin's mad scientists decided that anyone who doesn't conform to collectivism and doesn't agree to the collective and that Stalin is God on earth, you get to be condemned to a psychiatric hospital because you have a mental disorder.
And of course, by definition, you'd be crazy to criticize Stalin, right? Yeah. So there it's circular.
Well,
right?
This is where it comes from. So the left, ever since then, the left has gleefully condemned anyone who doesn't agree with them as needing psychiatric help. So if you, like Barack Obama, up until 2012, Barack Obama was homophobic, apparently. If you, according to Obama, if you don't support the progressive candidate, you're xenophobic. Pretty soon, if you're a woman who doesn't like men in your ladies' room, you're going to be transphobic. You're going to have a bad case of transphobia.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think pretty much we're all sick of this and sick of being smeared. Even the birther and birtherism. This was against people who simply asked the question. Since Obama said he was born in Kenya in his book pamphlet, he said he grew up in Indonesia and his father's from Kenya. People asked a logical question, well, why don't you release your birth certificate and your college records? And he said no. So you get smeared as if you're crazy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway,
or releases a forged document, like Sheriff Arpaio pointed out. Hey, you release a forged document. It's got multiple layers here, like Photoshop. It's obviously Photoshopped. It's got anachronisms and terms that are there. It's got fonts that don't match that are anachronistic as well. This is obviously a forgery. So please explain that to us. I mean, we just want an explanation. You know, that's why they call us conspiracy theorists. We're not conspiracy theorists. We just don't, we're not gullible. We won't take anything that you put out there simply because you're authority figures. We're going to look at it and say, does this add up? No, 2 + 2 = 5. And so then they call us conspiracy theories. You know, a lot of people questioned when we saw Hillary Clinton fainting, saw people on social media say, did she actually have an overexposure of patriotism? Because it wasn't really that hot that day, you know? She was just overexposed to patriotism on the anniversary of 9/11.
Right. It affected her. Well, look, the progressives like to present a fantasy. Stalin's fantasy of Soviet Russia was the government would own all the property, would control everything, and you would go to work in these factory jobs that don't produce anything, and you're going to be the happiest people on earth. If you don't buy into the fantasy, you get sent to the psychiatric ward. You must be crazy. Same thing with Obama's birth certificate that he eventually produced. It was a fantasy. It was a forgery. And if you don't believe it, you're a birther. So that's the MO. So anyway, I realized that when you really look at what these people believe and their thought process, I thought it would be good to brand them with a term. And I thought of Amerophobia, that because progressivism is the only real mental illness to speak of. So when the Democrats banish American flags from their convention, as they did, or condemn the police, I came up with an idea. Let's just point our finger at them and scream and yell, Amerophobe, you're Amerophobic.
That's great. You know, I guess, you know, they fear America, but they like certain things, right? They like globalism. Maybe we should call them global files. They're Amerophobic and global affiliate, or whatever.
Well, let me run down what they like and don't like. First of all, they really have disdain for American values. They believe our character is racist and selfish rather than tolerant and generous. They're very uncomfortable in the presence of the American flag, and they do consider themselves morally superior. Mm-hmm. Amerophobes also blame America for all international conflicts, even in remote regions of the world. They think America is the culprit. They believe we were a big colonial power, and we still are, even though we were actually a British colony. Amerophobes deify globalism, and they hate when our allies act independently, like Britain in the Brexit vote or Israel defending themselves from terrorism. The things that Amerophobes like, they love people who conform. They love the United Nations, International Criminal Court. They love government agencies that highly regulate Americans, like the EPA, IRS, FEMA, FDA. And Amerophobes trust government and government elites over their own judgment. And the reason for all of this is they believe in the fantasy of an imaginary utopia. And when America falls short of this fantasy, of this perfect society, this perfect collective, they conclude, well, America is evil. And so we want to bring it down. We want to turn it upside down. They want a society where truth and lies are indistinguishable. And that's why they promote blatant falsehoods against the police. Amerophobes also believe in open borders because it's our boundaries that protect our hated American character and independent national identity. So these are the very backwards ideology of Amerophobes, but you can see how this Amerophobia, I talk about it in my article on InfoWars, it really was introduced into the U.S. almost as a mental disease in the 1930s. Comintern, Communist International, through their affiliate in Chicago, CPUSA, Communist Party USA, they realized that the Marxist philosophy of total government control and collectivism was completely incompatible with the American way of life of free markets, individual rights, and open government. So they started a disinformation campaign, Disinformatia, and they promoted it through their Chicago office. The United States is oppressive, unjust, and corrupt. And over the years, this Amerophobia permeated our entertainment business, universities, and journalism, finally finding its way into a mainstream political party. And today, the Democrat Party is a radical, Amerophobic socialist party. Their entire platform, their presidential candidates, everything about them is Amerophobic.
You know, you mentioned entertainment, and it reminds me of the movie Hail Caesar by the Coen brothers, my favorite filmmakers. And central to that, they go back to the 1950s, it didn't do really well at the movie theaters, but I thought it was really funny. My wife and I both enjoyed it because it went back to all the different, almost stereotypes of Hollywood back in the 1950s. But at the core of the plot are all these communist writers in Hollywood who see it as their mission to change America into a communist country by using movies. And that's originally, you know, there was a truth at a very, very hard truth, a very large truth at the bottom of the search for communists. You know, they always want to say, well, McCarthyism is a witch hunt and so forth and so on. But at the core, they really were communists in Hollywood who really saw it as their mission to change America and to use the movies to do that.
Well, today in my article, I say, well, how can a person possibly become Amerophobic? Now, I'm from a small town in East Tennessee. I never grew up with any Amerophobic people. We believed in God and country and hard work, and most of America believes in that. But people that grew up in Amerophobic families, red diaper babies like Barack Obama. You've seen my film Dreams for My Real Father, where I show his real father was a Communist Party Soviet agent named Frank Marshall Davis. David Axelrod, both parents Communist Party members. Valerie Jarrett, communist family. So people that watch today, the millennials and generations since the 70s, if you grow up watching U.S. news media, if you study at a U.S. university, you're going to be exposed to Hollywood movies and TV that are all controlled by liberals and promote Amerophobic messages.
Yeah, absolutely. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Joel Gilbert. Has a great article at Infowars.com. Hillary Clinton promotes Amerophobia. She's probably the best example of this new term he coined. I think it's a great term. She's Amerophobic. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Joel Gilbert. He has an article on Infowars.com today. Hillary Clinton promotes Amerophobia, a great new term that Joel coined, because they're always talking about we have this phobia, that phobia, xenophobic, homophobic, so forth. They're afraid of America, and they hate America. That's the bottom line. It's a great term to use. You know, Joel, when I look at this, and we look at how Obama is promoting a trans agenda with the bathrooms and other issues, you know, the federal government coming in and telling us how we're going to structure bathrooms in private, on private property even, you know, in churches and so forth, not even on limiting themselves to public bathrooms. But, you know, when I look at this, I think maybe we should start calling these people transnationalists because they were born American or British or German, but they see themselves as globalists, you know? Well, so let's give it to them. They're transnationalists.
Well, because of their dislike for America, they start to look abroad to see where the perfect society might be. In the 30s and 40s, 50s, there wasn't a whole lot of news reporters in Stalinist Russia where they were throwing people in gulags and collective farms and starving people to death and murdering 20 million of their own people in peacetime. So you had American communists, including the black Bolsheviks out of Chicago, which Obama's father, Frank Marshall Davis, was one of them. They believed that the Soviet Union was this perfect society. They're always looking elsewhere, whether it's an imaginary utopia or heaven on earth, the communist system, which is in fact a complete disaster that leads to economic failure and biological destruction of all the societies that have adopted this. Also in the article, there's a video which is Hillary Clinton is an Amerophobe. It's a 4-minute animated video, which
yes, and that's a great video. We didn't play it because it's difficult. The joke is difficult to get across on radio because what it is, it's word association. And right. When you come through, you've got Hillary Clinton in a padded cell in an insane asylum, and they're saying, we're going to try to help you with this Amerophobia. As they throw up images, she tells you what she thinks of that particular image, and it's hilarious. It's a great bit. But all you hear if we play it on the radio is just her saying her comment, and you don't get the visual joke, which is really funny. People really need to watch that. That's embedded in the article on InfoWars, Hillary Clinton promotes Amerophobia.
Right. So it's kind of like a Rorschach test. We show a guy holding two ducks. He's a hunter. He's holding two ducks. And Hillary yells at him, mass shooter. There's Santa Claus on his sleigh in the snow. And she yells, climate denier.
Exactly. So yeah, that's great.
It goes on and on. So it's really going viral. So people should check that out on Infowars.com.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's an awesome video. Well, you know, we look at this and we talk about how they don't like America. They love other countries. There's a story on Politico, Joel. Obama, in an awkward twist, they say, becomes Saudi Arabia's defender. And I'm looking at this and it's like, becomes Saudi Arabia? This guy began by literally bowing and scraping to these people, and he's going to go out that way as well. But it's gonna, that's what it's going to be.
Well, we remember, you know, recently we had Obama doing a press conference in Cuba with Raul Castro, the butcher. And a few reporters, at least one reporter, said, hey, to Obama, hey, what about all the oppression and deprivation here in Cuba? And he said, oh, well, they have a different system. Rather, imagine instead of saying they have an inferior system that oppresses, has oppressed people and caused the Cuban people and their economy and life to be miserable for the past 60 years, he makes excuses.
And yeah, they got a different system. It's a system of oppression, which I want to bring to you, by the way. But the good news is they have all these classic cars because they haven't been working any new cars since the 1950s, right? That's going to be the gem in the economy when they sell those things off worldwide.
Right. Well, this is the fantasy. It's the leftist fantasy of some perfect society that's not America. Yeah. They're just absolutely ignorant. If they would look at the facts and compare America to the reality of the rest of the world, they would conclude that America is the greatest country possibly in the history of the world. But they're so miserable looking for this perfect utopia. They want to reject everything great about America, our flag, our freedoms, our right to bear arms, our free speech. And Hillary, by the way, wanted to add something a little different, that I'm convinced that if she becomes incapacitated as president in any way, I believe Huma Abedin will be the acting essential president. Hillary will hole up in the White House and Huma will essentially run the country. I think it's a very real possibility. If Hillary wins.
Well, she's kind of a Muslim Brotherhood mole that's been in there for quite a while. But, you know, it's, I guess she would see herself in the role of as first lady, kind of like Hillary was to Bill Clinton when Hillary tried to usurp authority there. Very, very great article and a great video. Go to, you can see that Hillary Clinton promotes Amerophobia, another viral video by Joel Gilbert. Hilarious video. You have to see it. We can play it on the radio for you because the joke doesn't work on the radio, but pass it around to your friends. They all need to see this. Thank you so much, Joel. Another great job on putting together a viral video. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about the hatred. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining us now, we're going to be going to him in just a moment, is Joe Biggs, our reporter in Charlotte. He's going to tell us what happened last night. And, you know, when I look at this, it's disturbing to me on a number of different levels. We've had the Tulsa officer who shot Terrence Crutcher charged now with first-degree manslaughter. And I agree with that. And I think that, you know, for too long we have seen the police, who used to be referred to as peace officers, who used to walk the beat. Now we see them being used as meter maids instead, provoking conflicts, and then when there is a conflict, they're not trained properly to deal with it or not physically capable of dealing with it. They're fearful. They act like Barney Fife, and that's, I believe, what was involved in this shooting in Tulsa. But on the other side of this, we've got Hillary Clinton tweeting out about the police shooting in Tulsa as this situation was developing in Charlotte, using that like a dog whistle, essentially throwing a Molotov cocktail into Charlotte. Where is the leadership? See, all we've seen from Obama is division, divide and conquer for political purposes. And that's what we're seeing from Hillary Clinton. She is willing to burn the city down as a demagogue, so for her own personal benefit, just like a Nero. I'm going to go to Joe Biggs in just a moment. Before we do, real quickly, I want to remind you that we have extended our sales for Secret 12 as well as Super Male Vitality at InfoWarsLife.com. Both of those are 20% off. Again, Super Male Vitality, you've heard Tim Kennedy talk about how valuable that has been for his training. You can read the reviews, the five-star reviews about Super Male Vitality at InfoWarsLife.com. And also, same thing with Secret 12, our vitamin B12 formulation. There are over 1,000 reviews now of B12, because that's one of Secret 12. That's one of our earlier products. And 4.8 out of 5. Read what people say about that. Read how it helps them. And of course, if you don't understand the benefit of vitamin B12, do some research on your own as well. See the forms that we have of this. And again, it's in a liquid form. No painful injections required to get a B12 supplementation. And we have put Secret 12, our B12 formulation, as well as Super Male Vitality. Both of those are still 20% off. We've extended those sales, but we're not going to be able to extend those very much longer and still meet the commitments that we have to our people who have signed up for AutoShip. And if you do sign up for AutoShip, then you never run out of supply and you get a 10% discount when you sign up for that. We have a lot of people who do that. That's why we have to end this sale soon so we can meet those demands for that. Again, both of these products, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. That will be ending very shortly. Now, joining us now is Joe Biggs in Charlotte. Welcome, Joe.
Hey, thanks for having me on, David. Before we get into what happened last night, I'd like to really talk about some of the events that have unfolded today. We have the wife of Keith Lamont Scott. She has released footage now of her from her cell phone before and leading up to the fact when her husband is shot and killed. Now, in the footage, you can hear her scream or hear the police screaming, "Drop your gun, drop your gun." But meanwhile, during that entire time, she's commenting as well, going, "He doesn't have a gun. He doesn't have a gun." And I believe she says something about how he has TBI and he just took his medication. So this video only fuels the flames, just like with what Hillary Clinton said. You know, she wants this place to blow up, essentially, because it's going to take heat off of her coming into this first debate and take the eyes off of her. So she could care less if Charlotte burns to the ground. She'll sit there and spark more racism just to go ahead and use that as a way to hide under that for a while so she could not get any kind of negative media coverage, which is what she's been getting a lot of lately. You know, and with this video coming out today, I think that's really going to spark stuff up. The Minnesota Vikings will be flying into town today and all of their fans, and they're playing the Carolina Panthers here at home Sunday. Now, the NFL's been talking about whether or not to move or postpone this game due to the tensions that have been going on, but the chief of police has come out and begged them to stay, and it looks like it's going to continue to happen. So you're going to have a lot of people coming in from out of state, a lot of people that are coming up here in this area that's already hot, and I'm standing at the epicenter where it is a building that is usually very vibrant. There's bars, there's restaurants, there's movie theaters, CVS's, you know, food stores, all this different stuff. And it's all shut down right now. It's all being repaired. And right behind me over my right shoulder is the Omni Hotel, where the second night of protests really sparked and turned into violent chaos here on the streets. And that's where a man was shot and killed. And they actually caught that guy with CCTV footage that the police was able to gather from cameras in the surrounding area. So with that being done, I was out last night with the protesters walking around. They all believe that this was a cop who shot this guy. Well, the police have now found footage that shows that it was a civilian, a protester, who shot this guy and killed him. And now we have rumors going around still that Keith Lamont Scott had no gun, that this was only a book. And now this footage comes out where you can't see the gun, but you hear the cops screaming he has a gun. And she's sitting there saying he doesn't own a gun. So I think it's going to make tonight just really very unpredictable. Last night wasn't really bad, but it definitely got crazy at one point in time when protesters took to 277, it's an interstate right over here to my right, and they ascended down in the road, stopped the traffic just before midnight. Riot police came in, started shooting pepper bullets, and then they charged at myself and a group of people, pushed us up a giant embankment, and I started getting pepper sprayed in the face. My skin is still burning, and my eyes were swollen until about 8 o'clock this morning. So it definitely heated up for a little bit last night.
But we were told in the national press that everything was just really calm last night.
They said there were small groups out, but I mean, there were thousands of people out at one point, and they were walking around. It was funny, the video you're seeing right now is of outside of the prison that's downtown. As protesters were marching down this road, cellmates inside were flicking their lights on and off, banging on the windows, screaming at the protesters, I'm assuming in solidarity or something like that, glad that they're out there, you know, marching against, you know, this police brutality that they're out here for. But, you know, at the end of the day, we keep getting these false narratives that are spun up on social media, and then it becomes truth, and everyone takes to the streets, and they're fighting, and they're becoming violent, and they're assaulting people. White people are being beaten and dragged through parking lots because they thought this was a racist issue, and it's not a racist issue. It is a black cop who shot a black man. The police say he has a gun. There's no definitive evidence of that yet. They have not released the footage.
That's an important point right there. It was a black cop who shot a black man. The chief of police is black. The mayor of the city is a Democrat, and yet they've turned this into a race riot. And when we look at Hillary Clinton, absolute silence for at least 24. I don't know if she's still. I haven't looked at her Twitter feed lately, but she was silent for at least 24 or 36 hours after this, except for the tweet about the situation in Tulsa, saying yet again, a black man has been shot by an unarmed black man has been shot by a cop, making it a racial issue. That's what she wants, is a race war. And that's how she is portraying this. Now, you know, when you're looking at this, and we got that video that's come out, have the police released any video of from their perspective, from their cameras? Because I guess if the wife is saying he hasn't got a gun, he hasn't got a gun. But we've seen a third party eyewitness say, you know, he took a picture of the gun that was there on the sidewalk. I don't know if that was a drop gun. But again, that wouldn't be a racial issue. That would still be a police issue. Nobody is talking. Hillary's not talking about any concrete reforms that they would do about the police. She wants to have a race war here. But have the police released any video of their own?
Well, here's the critical part of the whole thing. The police have not released the footage, but what they did is they allowed the family of Keith Lamar Scott to come in and witness the footage for themselves. And I got this information from some journalists who have been here for the last few days who know people here locally within the police force. And they said that they sat down, they let them watch this footage. And at the very end, they said, do you think that our shooting justifies based off the footage you shot? And the family looked at the police officers and said no comment and just walked away. So that kind of makes you kind of think, well, maybe they didn't see what they wanted to see, you know, because when you look at this, the wife's footage, she's back away. And all you can see is the cops yelling or hear them yelling. And then she finally moves up after he's been shot and is on the ground. So there's still a lot left, a lot left to be unseen. We don't know what's really going on yet. But based off of the family's reaction, the fact that, I don't know, man. I think tonight's still going to be, it's going to pop up again a little bit.
I would like to see, if Hillary says that she wants to be president to everyone, I would like to see her try to defuse this situation instead of using it for political gain. Because it's the racism narrative there. We have police that are engaged in unjustified violence and excessive use of force and shootings and so forth, and that needs to be investigated. She should call for calm until it is investigated. I mean, we've seen a picture of the gun on the ground. I don't know if he had a gun that was registered to him or if they're saying that was an unregistered gun, if it's an unregistered gun, and they're saying that he didn't have it. I mean, they need to work that out. We need to see the footage from all the different angles. And that really, I think, is something that the city government there really ought to do is put out their footage and say, here's our cards, let's stop the riot. But meanwhile, she is using this, and Black Lives Matter is using this to promote a race war. Every time we have a situation like this, especially if there's some ambiguity, they always seize on those particular issues and build those up because that's the narrative that they want, is that the police are against black people. And so, therefore, you ought to go out and attack unarmed white people who don't have anything to do with the police. That's the solution.
This has already been a battleground for LGBT rights, you know. The NBA playoffs or whatever, they pulled out. They're not going to be doing that stuff here anymore because of the transgender bathroom laws. You know,
they're moving those games to places where they don't have homosexual marriage, where they don't have rights for transgenders, where they don't have rights for homosexuals. That's where they're moving these games down into the Virgin Islands and other islands where they're transferring these basketball games, so forth. They're moving them to those areas, and they have less legal protection there than they do in North Carolina by far.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't make sense why this is all happening. But, you know, for some reason, this place has been chosen to be the next Ferguson. And, you know, from what we've seen the first two nights, it's definitely been worse because people have been shot and killed now. You know, the interesting thing about Charlotte is the amount of false narratives that are being pushed on social media and how they're becoming they're becoming truth and fact. And people last night were screaming and I could hear the rhetoric and everyone's like, he had a book and, you know, this and that. And, you know, the guy wasn't shot by a protester the other night. He was shot by a cop with a rubber bullet. And I'm like, well, a rubber bullet doesn't kill anybody. And it sure as hell doesn't leave a puddle of blood all over the ground. So these people are completely believing this false narrative. And they're willing to come out here and be violent and fight for it.
Yeah, basically what they're doing is they're creating a mob mentality. And Hillary Clinton is involved very deep in this, and I can't believe that the conservative media isn't calling her out more on it. I know that CNN and the mainstream media aren't going to call her out on that. But one of the things that I thought was interesting was the fact that 70% of the people that have been arrested, as we learned today, 70% are from out of town, out of state, I think.
Yeah, I got people from South Carolina, and then I heard a large number of these people came in from Atlanta, Georgia as well. Mm-hmm. People came in on buses and some of the trains. There's a train that comes through here. And, you know, that's been the word so far. So one of the guys that works for the police department here made a statement and said when they ran all the IDs, they believe that, you know, most of these people from out of town only to come here to start violence. And like that's one of the main reasons why I said tonight I believe might pop off again. Because you have a lot more out-of-towners coming in for this football game. You know, a lot of people are scared to be out, so it's pretty dead at nighttime. The epicenter right now has a few restaurants that are open to my right, but they have to close everything down at 4. Everything's boarded up. Most of the banks are closed down. There's only a few businesses that are out. Most people that are downtown right now are journalists, or people from out of town who want to take pictures of all the chaos that's happened, and construction crews trying to rebuild everything really quickly before, you know, it gets out of hand again. So they're boarding up all these windows. I mean, it definitely doesn't have the vibe to Charlotte that it used to when I lived here.
And, of course, we have Rachel Maddow and others saying that they're just cleaning the streets. They're not really looters. They're protesters. And not only that, they're street cleaners at the same time. What kind of destruction have you seen there? Because we've seen that they've you know, burned down some buildings. They looted even the NASCAR museum that was there in Charlotte. Have you taken any pictures or any reports about what you see in that area? What can you tell us?
Yeah, a lot of the businesses have been boarded up. Right here to my right is a place called the Epicenter. And like I said, a lot of nightclubs, not gas stations, but convenience stores. They're all boarded up on the inside. The outside part here, this is a Mexican cantina. It's not boarded up yet. But on the inside, all those places are boarded up. There's a street down here further away, about a block down, and then off to the right. Almost every business is boarded up where it was busted in. And it's pretty sporadic because the police were moving them around different sections. And then as they were able to lose the police, they would just start rioting in that area and breaking into buildings. So you've got a lot of action that happened down this way. The front windows were busted out in the Omni Hotel right over here as well. So, I mean, it definitely does not look like my Charlotte that I grew up in, that I'm from. It definitely looks like a war zone. It looks like the Gaza Strip almost.
Now, we've talked about how the people that have been arrested, the majority of them, 70%, have been even out of state. What about peaceful protesters? I'm sure you've seen some peaceful protesters there. What are they saying that they want? Or are they just talking about this in terms of Black Lives Matter and making this a racism issue? Or are they talking about doing some real reforms for everybody?
They had a lot of local community leaders that were in town last night leading some of these marches. At the beginning of the night, it started off as like sporadic little marches here and there. And eventually, around 11 o'clock at night, I believe, they all came together. And there was thousands of people out here in the streets. And they had some older black gentlemen that were community leaders that were leading more like Black Lives Matter type protests. They kept screaming, hands up, don't shoot. Resistance or revolution is beautiful. But really nothing about how to fix anything or any of the issues. They did everything they could at every intersection to keep the peace with all the younger individuals that were in the crowd protesting. But these guys that were still in the crowd were still throwing water bottles at the police officers that were on their bicycles and trying to spark something. So you still have agitators in these groups. They're trying to set something off because they know once it happens, then they'll be able to run around again. I've already had three or four people approach me going, hey, I think it's going to pop off again tonight. Make sure if it does, go inside the stores and get as much as you can, you know. So that's definitely the mentality right now that's happening here. You know, you've got some people that want to make it all about race, and then you've got some that just want to come out here and take advantage of the situation and release anger that they've had pent up for a long time. And they know they're not going to be caught, you know, 9 times out of 10 or anything's going to happen to them. And they're going to run back and play on their new TVs. So I don't see anybody really trying to do anything to fix anything. I just see more continuation of what's been going on around the country, and I don't see this ending anytime soon.
Yeah, you know, breaking out a window and grabbing a television set and running, that's not looting. That's just a protest. One of the things that we saw was
They were cleaning out the store. They needed a new inventory.
You're doing them a favor, store cleaners. We saw the video of the guy, the black guy who was going around and saying free hugs and hugging the police. We saw the people who criticized him for it. What you're describing there is that even sounds like even the most of the peaceful protesters, other than some individuals like that individual, many of the so-called peaceful protesters are really kind of inciting this kind of racist hatred amongst the people, even if they're not actually throwing stuff or doing violence themselves. So would you characterize it that way, or is that an unfair characterization?
I would say out of what I saw last night, maybe up to 5 individuals, protesters, you know, African-American females that were walking up to the police, and especially the head of the police department that's here in downtown, the uptown area of Charlotte. And he was walking around in the protest amongst the people, and people would come up. There was a girl. I have one of the live streams on Facebook.
We're going to have to cut it there at that point. Thank you so much, Joe Biggs, as our reporter live in Charlotte. And we'll be having more reports from him tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. The next hour is going to be hosted by Leanne McAdoo, and she'll have Owen Schroer joining her as a guest covering news and some of the things that we've got here. Which just again, this article that we were talking about with Joel Gilbert Amerophobia. You know, when I look at that, he talks about how the left hates America. There's an interesting article on The Hill by Armstrong Williams, who himself is black, and he says nationalism is the new N-word. And that really does describe it. That is the hate that is being engendered, as we see, even as we see racial division being fomented by Hillary Clinton on our streets. So I want to get to the news in just a moment. But before we do, I want to remind you that we have a free app that launched this week. And if you haven't noticed it, when I looked on Monday night, it was number 5 in the top 10 searched items on Apple's App Store. And I think when Alex looked at it, I think it was number 30 the next day in terms of free apps. But you can find it and link to it at Infowars.com/app. Now, what is it? It's a new app. We've had an app where you can listen to, on your phones to the radio show for quite some time. But with this new app, you can watch the radio show live on your phone as well as choose to listen to it in radio mode. But you also get the stories that we have. A very quick index. It's great organization of both our website, our YouTube feeds, our special reports that we do with the InfoWars Nightly News, as well as the radio show that you can listen to or watch. You can get all of that now in a free app. Again, you can find that at Infowars.com/app, or you can pick it up on the Apple and Android stores. Also, we've extended the sales for Secret 12 and for Supermail Vitality, 20% off at InfowarsLife.com. That's not going to last much longer. Now, when we were talking to Joel Gilbert, I mentioned this article about Obama in an awkward twist becomes Saudi Arabia's defender. Do you understand what he's defending Saudi Arabia from? They expect that he's going to veto the ability of 9/11 families to sue the Saudis. So even though they were telling us that the Saudis were behind it, they put this whole narrative out there, even had some documents that made its way into the official report telling us that there were officials within the Saudi government and ambassadors that were helping to fund the people that they said brought down the towers. Even as they're doing that, they're saying to Americans for 15 years, no, you can't sue them. That all blew up, didn't it? Why did it blow up? It blew up because Donald Trump said, release the 28 pages. It finally got traction, even though you had the people who had the senators who had headed the 9/11 commission were saying, we need to release these pages to the American public. They remained hidden. Why? Because they didn't want this to blow up in the way that it's blown up. So now you've got Obama in an awkward position. He has to choose sides, the Saudis or the American people. Guess which side he went with? The Saudis. Of course he went with the Saudis. He's going to tell them he doesn't want this to go any further. You know, if they start getting sued and a lot of money is involved, the Saudis might give up some more information that they know about what happened on 9/11. You know, if you're going to throw us under the bus, they say, for 9/11, maybe we'll turn stool pigeon and get some immunity here by talking about the people who were higher up that were really involved in this. Can't have that. So that'll be interesting to see how that develops. And that's going to be coming up pretty soon. He's going to have to make a decision one way or the other. Now, of course, on Monday night, we're going to have the debate. First time that Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump have faced off against each other. But really, you know what? This is going to be the first time that we've had an American facing the globalists. And I think it's going to be huge, as Donald Trump would say. I think it's going to be like the very first Super Bowl. We've never seen the two football leagues play each other. We have never seen anybody defending the American position in our lifetime against the globalists. We'll do that on Monday night for the first time. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, but already in the batting box, we've got Leanne McAdoo ready to take over in the next segment. You know, on Monday night, we're going to really have, I started to say at the end of that last segment, something that we haven't seen our entire life, and that is a matchup between an American point of view and the globalist point of view. It was last put out there by Robert Taft, the last American who would actually say that we should not surrender to the globalist. I think it's going to be very big. I think it's going to be, like I said, the equivalent to the very first Super Bowl. You know, we have people who get very involved in fantasy football league and everything. Understand this. NFL is all fantasy football. Okay, it's not the real world. This is the real world series, these debates, this election. It's real world. Okay? It's the one that really matters. You may not be interested in politics, but, you know, the politicians are going to be interested in you. No matter what you do, you can't escape these people. So start getting involved one way or the other to get into this. You know, we've had for the longest time, like I said, we haven't had an American versus a globalist matchup. We've had this Republican conference. We've had a Democrat conference. But they've all been playing for the globalist league, really. Okay, it's a very small distinction without any real difference. So this is the first time in my lifetime we've ever really even fielded a team. And now we see on the Drudge Report that there's not going to be a break for Hillary Clinton. That's big news. She also needs to have a podium there. I guess she can't wear high heels. That would be really dangerous, as wobbly as Hillary Clinton has been, if she were to wear high heels. And I guess there's nothing in there about her getting any pillows or handicap rails on the podium or the steps to get up on her stool that she's going to stand on to try to look like she's as tall as Donald Trump. The question is she going to be able to make it? Of course, there's another couple of articles that are up on the Drudge Report. This one from The Hill, Clinton's Eyes, a Window into Her Health Issues. I start out by talking about the 2014 Conan O'Brien spoof of Hillary Clinton with an interview. And when I saw that real video of her with the lazy eye that she couldn't get to focus, my wife and I were laughing about it. It's like, that thing has, that's real. I mean, so did they know that that was really going to happen? Did they do that to kind of give her a, kind of put that out as predictive programming so that when people saw what was really happening with her eyes, they would say, oh, it's not real. There it is right there. They're showing it if you're watching the video feed there. It's going in different directions. But they really are going in different directions. We've got doctors even like Rand Paul saying, hey, there's something going on here. This is not pneumonia, folks. Okay, not pneumonia. It's been going on for a long time. That's why I wondered if Conan O'Brien, some of the people who had talked with her privately, because she loves to meet privately with people in Hollywood, I wonder if they had noticed the eyes going in different directions. And did that to kind of help her. A lot of people, I'm sure, that the Democrats don't believe that that's real. And she keeps insisting she doesn't need a brain test. You know, she is ain't no way tarred, is I guess what she's telling people who say maybe we need to examine you. Pat Buchanan had an interesting editorial that was up on the Drudge Report from WND, talking about when he was running for president, and the advice that he got was, you don't need to win this thing. You just need to do better than people expect. And when he talks about that, this is the article, How Trump Wins the Debate. And he points out that what has been sold to the public is a cartoon version of Donald Trump. We've already seen Donald Trump, a real Donald Trump, as he met with the president of Mexico, as he went down to Louisiana, where Hillary Clinton was unable to, or too sick to go, or too disinterested to go, to talk to people down there. If we see a presidential Donald Trump, then he wins. He doesn't need to win all the little policy wonk issues. He doesn't need to go real deep on the details, get down in the weeds. People don't want that. What they want to see is he real? Can he be presidential? And I think that's what they're going to see on Monday night. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Leanne McAdoo.
And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. You have now entered overdrive, and I am Leanne McAdoo taking over the show. We have got a jam-packed fourth hour for you today. Owen Schroyer will be joining me at the bottom of the hour. We're going to discuss the upcoming debate, some of the rumors that are floating around. And we also want to talk about some of the questions that we hope to hear at this debate, as well as some possible solutions. Maybe we'll send a little tips out for Trump and Hillary. Hopefully she got that package of lung cleanse that we sent her so she can actually make it through this debate. You know, they've already said they're not going to give her a stool to stand on. So we'll see. I guarantee my bet is that she is going to be pumped full of all of the life extension technology that the globalists have at their disposal. But we will see. So I want to go ahead and throw to a video that Alex Jones put together talking about the big secret of this Trump versus Hillary debate, kind of give you the lowdown on how you can watch the debate with Infowars.com. So do you guys have that video ready to go? All right.
It's almost here. You can cut the tension with a knife. The first real debate for 90 minutes, head to head. Hosted at a university in New York next Monday at 8 o'clock Central until 9:30 Central. and InfoWars.com. We'll be covering it live on the scene and with our own feeds, as well as live commentary and analysis at InfoWars.com/show. A few weeks ago, I made the point that this could be bigger than the Super Bowl because the American people are really starting to wake up. And guess what? Top media analysts have now come out and looked at the early numbers coming in, and it appears there could be as many as 100 million viewers. That has never happened in history and will be bigger than any TV show, including the Super Bowl, that the United States has ever broadcast. But I wouldn't hold your breath. Something tells me there's less than a 50-50 chance Hillary's going to show up to this debate. In fact, she's only doing like one event a week and isn't doing any events now right through next Monday. That tells you how incredibly sick she is. And as Trump begins to surge in the polls, you would expect her to be out on the street redoubling her efforts, but she's not. So even if she makes it to the debate next Monday night, how is she going to be able to stand up there for 90 minutes? So I wonder what the numbers are if I was a betting man on her collapsing or having a coughing fit and having to cut the debate short. And don't forget, there's precedents for this. During one of the Democrat debates, they had to pause for like 10 minutes because she wouldn't come out after the, quote, commercial break. Ladies and gentlemen, you talk about edge of your seat. I don't care about sports and stuff like that because it doesn't matter. It doesn't affect my life or my children's future. But this does. I'm proud to see the American people so excited about this debate. And it's because we're finally getting somebody real to go up against the establishment represented by Hillary Clinton. This isn't sports. This is reality. We're not just spectators watching some basketball or football game. We're actually in the arena. This is our country. This is our world. And the sleeping giant is awakening. And InfoWars will be on the field at the event in New York and right here in Austin, Texas, with the live feed and live analysis. Join InfoWars for live coverage of the first debate, kicking off 1 hour before the debate starts at 7 o'clock Central at InfoWars.com/show. You can also sign up for our free newsletter and we'll send links out to you at InfoWars.com/newsletter. You can also go to InfoWars.com/app and download our new interactive app that has audio, video feeds, special live reports, and so much more. Again, watch the debate on your smart TV or at InfoWars.com/show or on the free app at InfoWars.com/app. From the entire InfoWars news crew here in Austin, Texas, I salute our fellow InfoWarriors, not just here in the United States, but worldwide. The revolution against global tyranny is being televised. This is the heart of 1776.
So there it is, Alex Jones breaking down how you can watch the debate live with us on Monday night. It's going to be the big showdown. Everyone is in total anticipation for this. We're just 45 days out now from the election. This is super exciting. What a pivotal moment in our country for our country. So I know all eyes are going to be on that debate. And I'm super excited about our new app. It's just in phase one right now. We've got some really exciting things coming down the pipeline for that app. So make sure you download it right now at InfoWars.com/app. Now, with the rest of this segment, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about something kind of frightening that's going on. We're seeing censorship hammering down in all directions at this point. Now, you'll recall the beginning of this month, YouTube started demonetizing people's videos, anything really that has news content in it or something that someone deems offensive, or if it has offensive language or content that makes people uncomfortable, it could be demonetized. It's just sort of an arbitrary thing. Well, now this censorship is coming at all angles. Now, first, I kind of want to back it up a little bit because whistleblower William Binney was on the show the other day with Alex Jones. And of course, you know, he worked with the NSA, worked to help develop a lot of these programs that are helping control us, keep track of us, surveil us. And of course, he programmed them in a way that was in alignment with the Constitution. And then they sort of got altered a little bit to be more befitting of what the globalist design had in mind. So let's go ahead and play this clip, William Binney warning Alex Jones and all of us about the one world government that's being constructed right now.
What about a larger plan? I mean, I know it's about looting and making money, hundreds of billions of dollars, you know, globally a year by these companies. But what's the master strategy
on building this technocracy? I mean, do they have one?
I think it's this is my impression, okay? Certainly, it is population control, but not just of any given country, but of the world. And so what they're after in direct, and I think Obama has stated this from various points, that he wanted a world community. So I think that's probably what they're after. In order to do that, they have to be able to control the people of the world. So in order to do that, you have to have knowledge of them to know who's doing what so you can stop it or manipulate it any way you want.
William Binney, that is the most profound thing I think I've ever heard you say, and you've said a lot of profound things. This is the key for a technocracy world government program, and Davos admits that's their plan, but here you are, the former leader of the National Security Agency, telling us that that's what they're building, a beast system. If you're not a Christian, it almost makes you one, doesn't it?
So that was NSA whistleblower William Binney, obviously exposing the fact that the NSA is being set up for total population control of the entire globe. Of course, he helped Oliver Stone with the latest movie, Snowden, to make sure that it was super accurate. That's a really great movie. But we've learned through these Snowden revelations how the giant tech companies were in collusion with the NSA, helping to scoop up all of that metadata. So let's talk about how these tech companies have become such a vital part of the control apparatus. They're almost a public utility at this point and more powerful than a lot of countries in some cases. So these tech companies are now consolidating at a record pace. Google is actually now looking to scoop up Twitter as we speak. Facebook buys up just about anyone that pops up to be their potential competition. And consolidation equals monopoly. And why we need to be concerned about that is because if the Trans-Pacific Partnership passes, this is going to give those consolidated tech giants so much power if we're talking about these corporate tribunals. These corporate tribunals are going to take over the adjudication of disputes. So if a country decides that it doesn't want to import GMOs, for instance, or toxic pesticides, these corporate tribunals can decide whether or not to allow that country to have its own sovereign laws, or whether it's going to, you know, have to import these corporate products. Who do you think they're going to decide? The sovereignty of the nation or in favor of the mega corporate interests? So that's why these monopolies are very concerning, especially when you consider how these tech giants are really backing this move to have the U.S. turn over control of the internet. And this is Obama's one last push, his one last thing that he wants to do before he gets out of office to help the globalist agenda. And now YouTube, in addition to their little move they just recently made to demonetize any videos they don't like, now they've unveiled a new program. It's called the Heroes Program. And they're basically going to be fighting trolls by hiring an army of volunteer trolls to take down videos that they disagree with. It's so ridiculous. It's like the brown shirts all over again. And so they only allow people in who are accepted into the program, and you have to go through all sorts of training. But each level that you kind of level up in this program, you get to mass flag videos that you do not like. So you can take videos down, they can moderate the site, they can make comments on other people's videos. And do you see this getting out of hand at any moment? I certainly do, because, you know, the demographics on YouTube is mostly like 15-year-old kids. But these are people who can flag any video that they don't like. And this is how YouTube is going to be leveling the playing field. This is what the founder of Jigsaw, which is a subsidiary company of Google and YouTube, he said that they're setting this up on all of their platforms, all of Google and Jigsaw's new platforms, to be able to, quote, level the playing field, because these voices, these dissident voices, have gotten so powerful. Like Paul Joseph Watson's channel, for instance, has gotten so much power that they say they want to level the playing field. But of course, what is he talking about? That's code for leveling the playing field and giving that power, restoring it back to the dinosaur media, who has become wholly ineffective. And that's what they mean. They don't want these dissenting voices to have so much power, so much sway over the population, because we can see how we've even been able to really knock the pegs down off Hillary Clinton. She was inevitable to win at this point, and now people are thinking she's not even going to make it through the next debate. Well, stick around because we're going to be talking about some more things going on in the country, and then Owen Schroyer will be joining me right after this. And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This is the Overdrive Hour, and man, I read the news today, and oh boy, I just cannot, literally cannot, every single day, even just looking at the Drudge Report, my goodness, some of the headlines, some of the thing that is actually news, actually stories, actually happening in our country right now. Here's one. Just going to go through some of these headlines. Mispronouncing student's name is now considered a microaggression. What isn't considered a microaggression at this point in this day and age? I mean, I am just so thankful that I'm not in school right now. I feel for all of you out there that are still in school and for all of you who have children growing up in school. You're really, really being tried right now. But this is a campaign initiated by the National Association for Bilingual Education and the Santa Clara County Office of Education. They say a teacher who mispronounces a student's name is causing a negative emotional state that can lead to poor academic success. Now, I do not even have that difficult of a name, and my name was beat up all the time in school. And yeah, you know, I remember growing up, kids told me I had a boy's name because my first name is Lee, L-E-E, and they would tease me that I was, oh, that's a boy's name. And yeah, you know, it might hurt my feelings a little bit, but my goodness, I was like a freaking genius student that they wanted to move to the smarter classes and stuff. If anything, it just turned me into a reader because I didn't want to go hang out with all the mean kids that told me I was supposed to be a boy. It's like, what is going to happen in this country when these people graduate and they have been cushioned and padded and pillowed at every single turn? There aren't coloring books on every single corner. There aren't little squishy, squeezy toys when you go to work and you have a tough day. I mean, it's just, we've got to toughen up here, people. Anything that's just going to help them build some character. Now, I know David Knight is always railing about the demise of the driver and how it's going to be taking away our freedoms when they want to do away with personal vehicle ownership. Well, I would like to do away with the people who are the troublemakers who are driving these globalists to take away all of our freedoms because they think we can't handle it. Here's another headline. Uber drivers are using zombie profile pictures to rack up cancellation fees. So these are Uber drivers in China. And so the way that they're scamming riders into paying a cancellation fee is that they're changing their profile photo to these terrifying zombie pictures so that when the people are trying to catch the ride, they're like, "Woo, no, I don't want to get a ride with that guy." And so then they cancel the fare. And so that will automatically give a few dollars to the driver since they got canceled on. I mean, my goodness, if this is not going to be just one more reason for Uber to do away with real, actual human drivers, it's that at every turn, people figure out how to scam the system. There were even stories out recently about some Uber drivers faking that people threw up in their car and saying that they had some drunk person, they picked up a drunk person and they vomited in their vehicle, and they go so far as to take a picture of fake whatever, you know, pea soup or who knows. And then Uber pays them like a couple hundred dollars to go get their car cleaned. And so they figure out how to totally scam the system. And this is why Uber wants to do away with humans. And it's also why you see the globalist elite want to do away with humans as well. Because why are there people on this earth who just, they cannot help themselves? They've got to figure out how to scam the system, how to ruin it for the rest of us, how to make it so that the surveillance state has to be so overreaching because none of us can be trusted with these freedoms. Oh, my goodness. And here's another one that I really was proud of. There's a video, it's on the Daily Mail, moment a woman rushes out of bed and opens fire on three armed burglars who broke into her home. She shoots one dead. The other two, I guess they might have escaped. But this is, the cops release this footage of release footage of the incident to try and identify the suspects. But everyone is like, wow, check out this lady. What a hero. She just gets up immediately from her bedroom and just takes things into her own hands. And some people, of course, are saying, well, why did she do that? You know, they weren't trying to hurt her. They were just trying to steal all of her stuff. Yeah, you don't know that. You don't know what these people were up to next. Now, I know tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News, Ashley Beckford is going to be playing a little teaser of her report. She actually went to go get a little bit of gun shooting experience for herself out on the range, the Girls in Guns training course that takes place here in Austin, Texas. And, you know, it really is time for us women who live at home alone, or, you know, if your husband's out and he might not be home for whatever reason, stationed somewhere else, we have to be able to take care of ourselves, take care of our families. I know I just got scared last night, and my dog, for whatever reason, my brand new puppy, he does not bark. So he's not a very good alarm system. And it is time to be able to take things into our own hands, to be able to protect ourselves, just like this woman in Georgia did. Kudos to you. This incredible footage absolutely has inspired the rest of us. Stick around. We will be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This is Overdrive, and I am Leanne McAdoo. Joining me now is Owen Schroyer, and we are going to break down the debate. What do we predict? What are some rumors we've been hearing about, as well as, you know, what would we like to hear about? This is our big shot to see Hillary versus Trump right there on the stage. Hopefully, this time around, they won't let Hillary Clinton say things like, I never sent any classified information, and just case closed, they'll leave it there. Hopefully they'll actually challenge her on something like that, because as we know, based on the FBI investigation that was released, indeed she did send classified information at least 100 times. And she also blamed her 2012 head injury, her concussion, on why she didn't know what that C marking meant, because she couldn't remember getting her training to help her understand what classified information was. But even in lieu of that, she still, to the face of that veteran, said, I never sent classified information and I always did my best. It reminds me of the time when she said, I try not to lie.
Yeah, I try to tell the truth.
I won't lie.
Yeah, well, she tries apparently not hard enough. Because
right.
She continues to be caught lying. And actually, Donald Trump is doing internal polling. I don't know if you've seen any of this, but he's asking his voters what issues they want to see him bring up. Do they want him to stay on political policy? Do they want him to attack Hillary? Do they want him to go after the emails, the lies? And when I took the vote, I said, you know what, let's stick to policy. I think that for you, in these debates, the best thing would be to stick to policy. But then, inevitably, Hillary Clinton's going to tell a lie, and you can just go ahead and attack her on the lie right there.
So is this a poll that he is conducting via his Twitter page, or where is it at?
These are polls that I've been getting in emails. I'm imagining I'm on the official Donald Trump email page or whatever it is, and I get these polls. I've seen like three or four of them. They don't show the results, but they do ask you what you want. And my guess is he's using this to kind of steer his debate rhetoric, steer the debate topics and issues where he wants them to go. I think he's very smart. I haven't heard Hillary doing anything like this.
Well, because she's sleeping.
Well, right. Where is Hillary? And you know what? I'm sorry, not to get off track, but you know, you said that. Where is Barack Obama? Where is Barack Obama? We have riots going on in Charlotte. I'm sorry, Leanne. I know I'm getting off base here. But Barack Obama has been silent. He hasn't been in the streets of Charlotte. He has been doing nothing. You know what he did? He licked his finger. He tried to figure out which way the wind is blowing. And then as soon as he knows what he can say that's going to appease everyone, he's going to speak. But I'm sorry to get off track.
He's only just got a few 45 more days, really, to push through his globalist agenda. So he's there hobnobbing with all of his buddies at the UN. That's where he is. He doesn't care about this country and black people. He does not care about you. I think he's made that evident over and over and over again. Look at the dire conditions you are in versus before that man got elected to office, which leads us to one of the rumors that we're hearing. If Hillary does actually collapse or can't make it to the debate, or if something happens, people are actually saying that they will replace her with Michelle Obama.
Yeah.
What do you think about that?
Well, actually, I have to give credit to one of our reporters here, Margaret Howell, who predicted this weeks ago. I scoffed at her. I thought that was completely unreal. No way. But now the rumors are starting to surface. You know, I'm not sure if this is something that's going to manifest or not, but if it does, doesn't that just show you how much of a puppet
the president is?
Well, think about this. If you're a Democratic voter and you voted for Hillary or you voted for Bernie, okay, either one, your vote didn't count.
Not at all.
Your vote never counted. They're just going to insert Michelle Obama in there. And of course, why? I think it's because they see that the black vote, you know, we have to
they
talk
get
about
that
this.
Black vote that Trump has started to take over.
I was on Twitter all day today looking, and I retweeted a couple things of this. Black people are becoming more outspoken for Trump than even white people to an extent, where I've never set up a pose or set up a stage where I've got a sign, a hat, a shirt, signs behind me, just everything that's Trump, Trump, Republicans, done with the Democrats. And we're seeing this happen all over mm-hmm. social media from black people who are either leaving the Democratic voting plantation or they've just seen what Trump is doing, heard what he said, and they really believe in him. I've never seen this phenomenon before. So
yeah, it's pretty powerful.
So that would be why I think they want to bring in a Michelle Obama.
Right. Well, and you know what? A lot of people like Michelle Obama. I like her. She seems like she's a good mom, a good wife or whatever. And as she famously pointed out in 2008, she knows how to run her household, unlike Hillary Clinton. So, you know, she can run the White House.
We can't get past that. You like Michelle Obama?
I don't dislike the woman. It hurts my heart when Alex says she's an unattractive man.
Well, look.
I don't think that's very nice.
I can't stand Michelle Obama. She comes off like a pompous, arrogant person to me, telling me what my kids need to be eating.
Well, then again, you know, with that whole school program, it's not like she was going to get in here and go against all of those huge food corporations that have got their tentacles in our school system.
So you don't think Michelle Obama has a codpiece?
I have never been inside of her pants. I don't know what sort of fish fillet she's working it.
But beyond that, though, I mean, I think that, you know what? I don't know if they're going to. I think Hillary's going to she'll go on and she could be 5 minutes from death. And the doctor could say, Hillary, you're going to die if you go on that stage and try to debate. And she's going to, you know, give him the finger and go out on that stage.
Listen, Matt Drudge was here in this studio and he predicted it. He said the American voters, they don't even care. And the rulers or whatever think we're so stupid that we don't even need a real body. We could have Hillary Clinton's brain in a jar. That's what he said.
Yeah, her head on a stick. Was that what he said?
Her brain in a jar. The desk there in the Oval Office. So they could just roll someone out at the last minute who hasn't been vetted, who has no plan, who hasn't gone to the debates, who hasn't done anything to state their case to the American people, to decide if they want this person representing them or not.
Right.
And that just goes to show you, yes, how controlled it is and also how much of a puppet the president usually is, which is why they're so afraid of Trump, because he's not bought out by anyone yet. And we are going to hold your feet to the fire.
And now his latest campaign strategy is he's going to donate $2 to every dollar donated to his campaign in one final push. But, you know, you talk about the controlled race. What would the outrage be? I mean, that's what would be curious to me. If they just bring in a Michelle Obama, okay, with no vote, with nothing, mm-hmm. they just decide they're going to go with Michelle Obama. Will there be any outrage from the Bernie supporters, from the Hillary supporters, or will they just,
Michelle, we like her.
Woo.
Yeah.
And what do you think about this, Lan? Because Drudge Report, Matt Drudge, actually in a rare exclusive, talked about the rules that were going to be enforced or not enforced coming up in this first presidential debate. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't seem like Hillary's going to have any advantages that she might have thought that she was going to have. I was kind of shocked.
Incredible. Yeah. I know. Do you think that she at all is beginning to feel the heat? Like, wow, I thought I had everything in my pocket. Mm-hmm. They told me this was my time. And now even they can't even wheel Weekend at Bernie's Clinton around anymore. Even they're saying, wow, I'm sorry. You know, you've collapsed on video with quote unquote pneumonia.
Well, and disregard
tell us about
even,
some of these debate rules.
Well, disregard even the videos we've seen where she clearly has health issues, whether it be her eyes staggering or seizing up or falling over, coughing.
Coughing.
I mean, the list goes
years.
On and on. This is such a joke. The glasses.
The
I mean,
blood
it's,
clots,
all, it's on and on.
The FBI investigation admitted concussion trauma.
But, you know, you said this is what's amazing to me. Okay. They've said they're going to go 90 minutes. They said they're not going to give her the stool. They're not going to do any coughing breaks. So,
and the mics are going to be hot. The whole
mics
time.
Will be hot the whole time. So if
she
anything happens,
4 minutes.
If anything happens, what is she going to do? Is she going to walk off the stage? Is she going to try to save face? You know, I mean, it's going to be a very interesting situation. And I think that you asked me, do I think she's panicking? Do I think she's feeling the heat? I think that the video that she did where she's like, why aren't I winning by 50 points? I can't believe I'm not up 50 points. If you look at her in that video, she looks like a criminally insane human being.
So insane. Can you imagine her being our dictator?
Oh, my God. She would be the
leader?
Dictator.
That is what we're going to have to listen to in every single weekly address. Why are you doing this? Like, oh, I'm leaving. That's my prediction. Leah McAdoo is moving out of this country if that woman wins.
And there's the video right there. Just look at that. That is the face of a criminally insane person right there. And she's angry. You know why she's angry, folks? Because her little slaves, her little constituents aren't doing what she wants them to do. Hillary's slaves, the voters, she thinks should be rushing to the polls and voting for her en masse, and they're not. She's getting her tail whipped, so there she is going criminally insane.
Yeah.
Why aren't the slaves voting for me?
Why?
They were supposed to vote for me. Ugh, I'm Hillary. Vote for me, slaves.
That's why that video was only about a minute long, because, you know, that's about all the energy she could muster up for that minute. But
that was a bad day for her. You know, I talked to
why
a lady.
Did she do that?
I talked to a lady who is at that rally, okay? This is the weirdest thing. I've never heard of it. This is a presidential campaign, folks, okay? You're trying to be the president of the United States. Hillary Clinton goes to a small venue, okay? There's two rooms in this venue. One that could hold 600 people. One that could hold about 100 people. She goes to the room that could hold 100 people. She locks it down for media and VIP people only. There were some disabled people she had in there. And then everybody else, the people who actually went to see her, the actual voters, were put in the overrun or the overflow room. And they watched Hillary speak on a television screen. Okay? Plenty of room in the room to have everybody in there and have her on the stage. And she doesn't do it. And then after that rally, she goes and does the video that we just played going criminally insane. Why aren't the slaves voting for me? I think she is feeling the heat, Leanne.
Yeah, but because she can't control the fact that other people are able to get footage that they're uploading to Twitter right away, showing the actual size of her campaign rallies, where she has her operatives going in and photoshopping in a bigger crowd to make it appear as though she has a bigger crowd. And then people are like, well, wait a minute, that's not what I have on my picture right here, which is I was there in person. And then let's look at these other dirty tricks that they're up to. So this is up at Infowars.com. Clifford Cunningham has a story. DHS rubber stamping citizenships prior to the election. So the DHS is approving as many citizenship applications as possible in an effort to directly influence the presidential election. So in every single way, we got Facebook, Google with all their algorithms and Twitter recommending who you should follow on Twitter. Even if you're a Trump follower, it says you should follow Hillary or Obama or Ted Cruz. And if you go to Obama's page or Hillary's, it doesn't say follow Trump. I mean, it's all totally biased. And here, now they're even really working overtime to get people to become citizens of this country before they even know what's up, before they even have any idea of how this country works or if they're proud of the way, you know, being here.
No assimilation process.
Give them the right to vote right away. And we need you to vote Democrat, by the way.
Well, and let's be perfectly clear. This is not because the Democrats care about these people. This is not because the Democrats have a big heart. You know, this is because the Democrats want a voter block. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I've done a report on this before. The way the Democrats have been rigging elections in recent years is they have voter blocks in the inner cities. If you actually go out and you look at how the counties and the districts break down and then the Electoral College, you're going to find something astounding, folks. The only blue areas on the map are in the inner cities. That's it. If you had a county by county breakdown of the entire United States, it would almost be entirely red, except in the inner city. So this is where they established their voter block. And now, as you're talking about, Leanne, they're trying to establish a new voter block because I think they're starting to lose some of those votes. I think they're realizing that the heat is on. They need to bring in these immigrants. They need to bring in these refugees. They need to rubber stamp them the right to vote. And then, of course, what are they going to say? Well, we're going to give you a handout. We're going to give you a place to stay. We're going to give you a bus pass. We're going to give you a meal. And this is the Democrats. If you want this to continue, make sure you vote Hillary. If you want to be shipped out, you better not vote Trump. So this is clearly an effort to create a voter block and rig this upcoming election.
Right. Well, it's just like in a lot of minority communities, they'll have the Christmas ham or the Thanksgiving turkey come out. You know, you got to vote. Here's your big turkey dinner. You know, we're going to give you this big giant turkey to feed your whole family. Just sign your name right here, vote for this guy, keep your local mayor in office or someone who hasn't been doing anything for you at all for 100 years in these Democrat-run cities. But we're going to go ahead and just throw you, literally throw you a bone, chicken bone or turkey bone or whatever it happens to be, so you can feed your family. And this is kind of the carrot that they're dangling in front of these people, keeping them year after year locked in these dire situations that they're in, not educating them on how they should really be voting or how they're really being held back and how voting for this constant welfare state isn't actually helping them get ahead. It just may be helping them barely scrape by in the present moment. It's really sad to see. And it's going to be kind of the same in the future, because with this redistricting and new voting blocks with the gerrymandering, that's something else that's really going on in the future. I mean, they're playing the long game here. So and we better hope someone gets in that can shake the Etch-a-Sketch, I think.
And these are the political games that get played throughout these election cycles that I think people are finally starting to understand. Other than InfoWars, people are starting to shed light on these things. And I think that's a great analogy with the carrot on the stick. It's like they put the carrot on the stick and, you know, you keep moving to the carrot and they say, oh, well, there'll be more carrots. There'll be more carrots. And what have we seen? And Donald Trump talks about this. What, the inner cities haven't gotten any better. I'm from the city of St. Louis, okay? Inner cities run by Democrats, and this has been a declining city. They've had they've had some things come along and come and go, but the city itself never seems to grow. It never seems to really, I don't know, experience any sort of a positive reaction from the new projects they bring in. They bring in the new projects, they promise you that it's going to be different, and then it's not different. It's still the same. They end up getting run down. It still stays the same city. So, but these are Democrat-run cities, and this is. Again, I think that they're freaking out is because they're losing the faith in the people they've been relying on.
Yeah, because people are finally getting their information from these alternative means, which is why they really want to crack down on the internet and quote unquote level the playing field for these strong voices that are out there. But look at what a slap in the face it is to say the people of Detroit, for instance, where they have been crying, begging for help for all these years, living below poverty level. Their city is in ruins. No jobs. And what do they say? Literally come out and say, we are going to give the homes, the jobs to the Syrian refugees. We're going to bring in refugees and allow them to take over this city and let them flourish. Let them do this. No, we're not going to help the people that were there that have been begging us for assistance all this time and have been paying whatever little they could in taxes to try to get their streets fixed or their homes or whatever, what have you. I mean, what a slap. That's how they really feel about you. That's what they really think about you. So when they make all these political promises, you have to look at the track record. What have they actually done for you? And don't just fall into the identity politics of, oh, it's the first black president or, oh, it's the first female president. They're globalists at the end of the day. That's what they are. They have an agenda. And just like the members of their party, look at the track record of how they have taken care of your cities and your states and how they've destroyed them and how you're paying astronomical tax rates.
And that's right out of the Clinton camp, too. That Syrian comment, rebuilding Detroit with Syrians, that's right out of the Clinton camp. I mean, let's put Americans first. Is that so outrageous?
Mm-mm. I mean, and that's exactly what Trump said. Like, let our children be dreamers, too. Give them the opportunities. So we are going to be right back with another 5 minutes of Overdrive. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. You are now in Overdrive. If you are watching us live or if you'd like to watch us live, you can do so on our new app. Be sure to go to Infowars.com/app. Download the new app. It's in its first phase and it's already badass. And we have so many things planned coming down the pipe. We've got such an amazing team right now with so many really good ideas. And we're going to help really personalize it so we can connect with you all directly and talk to you. But for now, you can stream us live, especially the debate that's going to be coming up Monday night. We'll be going live 7 p.m., about an hour before the big showdown begins. So you can, of course, watch that at Infowars.com, as well as our YouTube channel and the brand new app if you want to watch it on your phone. So now let's talk a little bit about what's going on in Charlotte. I know we've got our reporter Joe Biggs on the ground there. But we've seen all sorts of things. It was much worse than what happened in Ferguson. We were seeing reporters getting attacked and tackled, just like our guys were, where CNN, MSNBC, when Jakari or Joe Biggs was actually getting sprayed with pepper spray or hit with rubber bullets, they came out immediately saying, oh, no, they didn't. And we're like, yes, we did. We have the evidence right here. Well, now their reporters are getting tackled, getting tear gassed. But there's also a video, which I don't think we have time to play it, but MSNBC was actually, as we're watching everything roll out on the video, they're saying that these rioters are peaceful and they're just hugging each other, cleaning up the streets. They're just cleaning up trash. And I saw another frame where it was saying, neighbors visit their local police department. Just a friendly little, they thought the police
friendly gathering
needed a little upgrade of their police sure. vehicles, and that's why they were smashing them to bits.
Yeah, it was a... It was a makeover. They were just giving the city a makeover.
A upgrade.
But I remember, you know, I was in Ferguson with those guys, and we always talked about how that was the craziest thing we'd ever seen. That was the most tense atmosphere we'd ever been in. And I wasn't in Charlotte, but just watching it, I could tell that it was much worse, much more violent. It's very sad, but, you know, there were some things in common. A lot of the people that were caught were not from the Charlotte area. That was a similar thing to what we saw in Ferguson. And I think that you can explain that by one of two things. They're either funded by George Soros to go there and cause chaos, or these are just criminals. These are just lowlifes who just want to take advantage of a situation and go loot or rob
or
just be on TV, whatever it is.
It'll be really interesting to see what happens. I guess the football game this Sunday that's going to be in Charlotte is still on. So it'll be very interesting to see if anything happens then. I'm sure there's going to be some peaceful protesters outside. But get to this article.
I think,
article that's going to blow your mind.
I think that I have the solution right here, okay? You know, we got these protests going on. We got police brutality. Well, Bloomberg.com has the solution to all of it. Want to slow climate change? Stop having babies. Folks, I'm quoting this. This is an article from Bloomberg. I'm reading directly. Carbon dioxide doesn't kill climates. People do, and the world would be better off with fewer of them. Oh, my God.
Where have we heard this before?
Well, of course, TED Talks, when Bill Gates, you know, talks about using his vaccines
to get
the population down to zero. Uh-huh. This is real, okay? The eugenicists are taking the mask off. They hate you.
But why are they
hate you.
This is Bloomberg. Who is Bloomberg's audience? This is already people who maybe even have one child, but they wait so long to have a child because they're overly educated, and they might decide to have one kid, but then they can't because they wait
too
long.
It's like an Idiocracy.
Yeah, it's like... Yeah. So you're basically telling your audience, who's already taken the advice of the globalists from back in the 70s, to stop having children.
Can you imagine, Leanne, if Infowars.com said, we have a solution to police brutality, we have a solution to protest, eliminate people, end humanity, humans are bad.
That would be the
ultimate. Make America free again.
That would be the ultimate solution. Well, you guys, stick around. We got the Infowars Nightly News coming up tonight, 7 p.m. Central.
Slavery. The United States only has 45 days for the most critical general election in its history, the final countdown.